Welcome to the most intense week in the history of the world, and we're choosing to look at it in a positive light. Positive light. What is it that we can get out of this week for our greatest benefit? Of course, we know that it's a tipping point, it's a changing point, it's a pivoting point of the world. There's no question about it. I mean, too much is adding up to just completely dismiss it. So, but how can we tip things in our direction? This is the question. Had a dream a couple nights ago. Not sure what to make of it. Last night, well, there was one dream. What was it? This is a little odd. I tell you. I was by the ocean on a cliff, somehow traveling around this area, and there was this baseball pitcher. Left-hander. It was actually Sandy Koufax. And I was watching his delivery, and I noticed that he was, in his delivery, he was taking a hop before he was throwing the pitch. And so we slowed it down his delivery and looked at it very carefully. I said, hey, wait a minute. That's not the right delivery. He's taking a jump. It's not legal. It's not legal. Sandy Koufax's delivery is not legal. What does that mean? Well, I know that Sandy Koufax is known for taking Yom Kippur off that date in the baseball calendar, the most holy of Jewish days, Day of Atonement. And he was very famous for that. He said, no, I'm not pitching on this day. So why would Sandy Koufax come up when Yom Kippur is the 23rd? But is it really the 23rd? Or is it skip a day ahead? The 24th, he was jumping a little bit ahead from the rubber, so he jumped ahead. Very interesting symbology. Isn't our dreams just extraordinary? Because they didn't see the moon, the new moon on the Rosh Hashanah, the 13th or 15th, it was the 14th, 15th. I don't know what day that was, but maybe it was, but. There was a sandstorm. They couldn't see the moon, so they had to put it one day ahead, which means, does that mean the Day of Atonement is also put one day ahead? It's possible. And that's what that dream was showing me. Sandy Koufax jumping off the pitching rubber a little bit, like, you know, getting ahead one day or something. Wow, what's going on? Anyway, this week is the conjunction of so many issues. But we're looking for a good one. Now, the dream I had a couple nights ago. Don't know what to make of it. I don't know what to make. But suddenly in this dream, deep down in the middle of the core of my being, suddenly this famous guru appeared in this dream. And I was like, oh my gosh, how are you? And I was just so happy to see them again. And so the emergence from the deep depths of my being of this famous guru. But, I don't know what to make of this. It might be good, it might not be good. I don't know how these things work out, but it was very profound and very significant. But in terms of gurus showing up, I've been burned so badly before. I'm not going to make any prediction of you know what could happen. Whatever, it's very tricky when these gurus show up in your dreams. You know what does it mean? Does it mean that someone is going to actually show up now? I don't know. I don't know. We'll find out. But meanwhile, we want to shepherd ourselves along through this week, and starting today, maybe we'll give it maybe in eight days a week, going through the 28th. But if we start today, what is the day? The 21st, 21st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th. Well, that'd be 8 days through the 28th. It would. But we don't want to get into numbers here. So I was getting into numbers earlier, and I was getting irritated. The kids on the internet can be very irritating. They just copy everybody else's article, and you see it 100 places, and then it's just the internet can become very irritating. I said, wow, where's all the positivity? Where's someone talking about sanctuary? Where's somebody talking about, real super positive enlightenment stuff? That's very hard to find. Very difficult to find, actually. And also all the number crunchers of the Protestants and the date setters and the raptured date centers. And there just seems to be an endless stream of books written by Protestants who, predicting, this and this and this and this and this. But they never tell you how to be saved. I mean, I don't think anybody in the world knows how to be saved. I might be the only one. I don't know. It's bizarre. It's bizarre. That's called legalism. Getting caught up in numbers and in legalism and not understanding how to truly be saved. Now Jesus says that save forgiveness, forgive ourselves, which means to completely let go, completely accept that there's absolutely nothing of this world that has the slightest thing to do with what we really are. And there's also absolutely nothing that in any of our thoughts or concepts that have anything to do with what we are. And forgive ourselves for ever thinking that there was. This is what he calls forgiveness. He says, and under no circumstances ever does forgiveness ever have anything to do with forgiving somebody else or what they did to you. Was absolutely adamant about this. So here's someone who talks about salvation. At least, he gets right into it. Now today I said, Jesus, what if you show up today, I'll give you a fair hearing. I'll listen to what you have to say. And I absolutely meant it. And nothing showed up today. Very disappointing. Because I'm willing to sit down and say, what do you have to say? I'll give you a fair listen. I'll give you a fair hearing. What else can we do? I mean, what better offer can you possibly make? I'll give you a fair hearing. I've been giving the Holy Spirit a fair hearing for 40 years because I've been giving the ego continuity fear a fair hearing for millions and maybe billions of years, right? So at least I can spend 40 years listening to the other side, the other option. I mean, what am I here for in this world? I wanted to find out what are our options. This is my business. I mean, I've let other people go about their business. I attended to my business. This is how I approach the world. You tend to your business, fine, I won't bother you. I'm going to tend to my business, you don't bother me. My business is to find out what are our options. What are our options? This is what's important. Our options. Do we know what our options are? If we don't know what our options are, how can we choose? If we don't clearly see at least two options, how can we choose between them? If we can't clearly see what the difference? So I have literally spent my entire life trying to discern in this world what are our options. And I've found out that we have two basic options. So I've succeeded in recognizing, what are our options. We have two options, really. And one is vastly superior to the other. One shortchanges us very, 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 very severely. In fact, it's such a bad option that it has to completely blind us to the other option lest we immediately see, what a terrible option it is. So there's the problem. The options that we're following in this world is so terrible. We're shortchanging ourselves so severely that this option expends, enormous effort to blind us to the other option. So we're not even aware it exists. So in this world, it is extraordinarily difficult to see the other option because this world is designed to blind us to it. It literally is designed to blind us to this other option so that we don't realize how vastly superior it is to the one that we have been engaging with. And of course, it's so difficult here. It is so difficult. Now, having seeing this, what this other option is, I don't want to lose sight of that. And this marketing campaign that's going to take place in the world, marketing the other option, the one that shortchanges us, is going to be so severe that I might even lose clarity on what the other option is. That's how blinding this world is. How blinding the senses are, the body, the senses, this world, the belief systems, everything is so blinding. Very few even are aware of this other option we have. And it's easy to lose sight of it here. Very easy to lose sight of it. So I certainly want to protect my clarity about this other option, the one that is a great option. And I'm not going to... You've got to be careful about trying to explain it, because you can damn it with faint praise, with faint words. Words that give a very poor impression, just to say the least. I can be aware of it within, but when I try to explain it, it tends to get very fuzzy. But I've done a good job in all these videos is to point it out. I mean, basically, we can stop pretending that we're not what we really are. That's what the option is. We can stop pretending that we're something different than what we truly are. Whereas the terrible, terrible option we're following now is the option of believing that we can make pretending real and permanent. Pretending that we're something different than what we are, we can make that real and permanent. That's the option the world is dedicated to, the option that the world is following, and this option tries to blind us to the other option, which is we can stop pretending that we're something other than what we are. So there you go. I was able to, you know, put it out in words there, clarify it. Very simple. It has to be very simple like this, and see it simply. Now, this week is so historically important because this is when the great campaign kicks off for the lesser option to try to present its best face and say, you know, this lesser option guy, you know, everyone is like really great. And, you know, in fact, it's going to be way better if everybody accepts it. When everybody accepts it, magically it'll become awesome. This is how it markets itself. So this great campaign is being kicked off. Now, those who realize that it's fundamentally, we're shortchanging ourselves to an unbelievable extent, it's a terrible, terrible option. And the other option, that we can stop pretending to be something other than what we are, is a wonderful, wonderful, glorious option. Where we don't want to be marketed to, you know, we don't want to be influenced by this marketing campaign. We don't want to lose clarity. So, we want to take refuge, I mean, take sanctuary, and not be pummeled by this marketing campaign. So this is what this week's all about. It is the pivotal moment in history where we put the biggest marketing campaign in history. Keep in mind, in past times, we didn't have the internet, we didn't have global communications, we didn't have smartphones, we didn't have social media, we didn't have the means to supersaturate the world almost instantly, right? Not at all. So the blitzkrieg effect that we have available to us now is infinitely stronger than anything we've ever had before in history. So we most certainly can be subjected to the greatest blitzkrieg in history. Nothing even comes close. And this is what's coming. This is why this is the most pivotal week in history, because this is the kickoff of the blitzkrieg. Marketing blitzkrieg, the pressure blitzkrieg. Now, it just so happens that this 23rd of September we're in now the 49th year of Jerusalem being retaken by Israel, 1967, June 7th, 1967. So we've completed 48 years since that date, and now we're into the 49th year, and it's 108 days from that date to September 23rd. 108 is a super significant number. It's the number of pressure points in the human body. So you might say 108 signifies all pressure points. In other words, all pressure is going to be put upon us. It's also the number of beads in the Hindu necklace, mala, Rudraksha beads, sorry, I already pronounced it, 108 beads. 108 beads, and as they do japa or prayers, they use these 108 beads. It's very significant. Buddhism, also 108 questions, 108 answers of Buddha, Hinduism, Buddhism, and it's a very, very significant number, actually, 108, right on the 23rd. Isaac Newton said that in the 49th year, at September 23rd, if you use 360-day prophetic years, you get exactly September 23rd. 215. So there's all sorts of people chiming in, but where is the beef about what they're saying? They're just saying a date, this is blah, and this date. But that doesn't really tell us, you know, how to read salvation at all. It's empty. It's flat. It's flat. All this stuff on the internet is very, very flat. Very, very flat. And it's very irritating. You know, it's just, I mean, you have a date, so what? I mean, how do you prepare? You know, how do you prepare? Yeah, we know this week in history is important, but I'm saying, why is this marketing campaign that is going to commence from this week, maybe starting on the 28th, the blood moon of the 28th, starting that day, there's 266 days, pregnancy period to June 21st, 216, which the Holy Spirit told me, you must be ready by that date. Well, that means the marketing campaign is liable to last 266 days. At that point, people will be convinced by this marketing campaign to go along with this terrible option of really ultimately trying to make pretense permanent, which is to confess a creed of I am a human. I am human. What is it like to be human? And Google, I've said Google's already kicked this off by promoting the movie, you know, Human. And then it says we're all something that we all share in common, that we're all human. Well, this isn't true at all. In fact, nobody's human. It doesn't exist. It, pretense is not something in itself at all. It has no self-existence whatsoever, pretense. And we're spirit pretending to be other than what we are. We just label this pretense, you know, human, as if these forms are actually some real self-existent things. They're not. They're not. There's no thing in itself, really. These are just appearances, like in a dream dance of a dance, dream dance. So we're working to get depth to this week. We're working to get depth here. And we've been shown a lot of indications that something really profoundly great is coming. It could be in this week, to correlate with this campaign. There may be another campaign kicked off, designed to market the other the good option that we have, which is we can stop pretending to be something that other than what we are. That's the other option. We can either keep pretending or we can stop pretending. Those are the two options. There's no other options. There's no such thing as both pretending and not pretending as an actual destination. There is the form of both this and not this in terms of satisfying our continuity fear to go become passive. All the forms are continuity. It's a period to go passive and honoring our creativity. But this is a very different thing than actually arriving at some sort of actual identity based on that. See, so there's no identity based on trying to combine both options. You can't say, well, we're pretending to be something that we're different than what we are, and we're also not pretending to be something different than we are, and that is our identity. No, that doesn't work at all. It doesn't work at all. But we can say to our continuity, all our continuity expressions, we can say, I'm both pretending and not pretending. And then this, they accept this as their endpoint, so to speak. Not as their identity, but as their endpoint, where they become passive and quiet and peaceful, as everything's peaceful and peaceful mind. And it allows us to honor our creativity this way. It's sort of a peace treaty with where they say, okay, we'll stop trying to hold you hostage from this formulation, neither nor, the neither nor formulation. But neither nor is not our identity, you know, or it's not our identity. It's a way of resolving the continuity problem. But most certainly, the option, there's either only two options are mutually exclusive. Either we continue to pretending we're something different than we are, or we stop pretense of being different than we are. That's the only two options possible. There's no third option at all. Not as an act, not as actual being, identity, not as actual what we are. It's not possible. It's either one or the other. So there's going to be a campaign kicked off this week to accept that we're human, and that, in other words, that our pretense is real. And how can we make this experience, you know, real for us and feel good about it and satisfied? And so why shouldn't there be a campaign also kicked off in the same week promoting the great option we have, which is to stop pretending that we're something different than what we are? Why can't there be a campaign kicked off in that way? Now, we know, I know, at least that Jesus is already back in it, and how this will surface, we don't know. It seems as though there are two other teachers, at least Ramana Maharshi and Longchenpa also are back. How that plays out on the surface also, we don't know. The other one is Ananda Maima. That's the one that I had the dream about. But she's a wild card. It's very hard to figure out, you know, what's going on there. But what, looking at it in a positive way, I looked at it and I said, well, it's very difficult to understand, you know, how that could play out. The others seem more straightforward. The last thing we need to do in this world is empower women anymore. They're already completely out of control, actually. It's unbelievable, the vibe I get now in the world. They're just full of this horror Babylon mischief attitude. It's just amazing. Their attitude is so humanistic. It's extraordinary. And it said, oh my God. And someone just told me, just relating a story, the woman just said, hey, to the men, said, hey, I'm the boss. You know, says, you need to go back to work. You need to buy me this. You need to buy me this. And he said, no, 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 no. She goes, what do you mean? No, I'm the boss. I'm the boss. This is the attitude that women are the bosses now. They're a very, very bossy attitude. And it's extremely worrisome, actually. I don't know how it's possible to go forward. So the only, you know, thing I could say about Ananda Maima is that she certainly knew how to keep women in line, and she could tell them, you know, they couldn't, they tried to boss her around, they could not. And she seemed to be able to protect men from very bossy women, which she did. And she actually protected men's spiritual practice from a lot of the influences of the modern world. And so if that was her function, is to protect men from this intense horror Babylon attitude of many modern women who want to disrupt men's spiritual focus on this higher option, this true option that we really want, then that would be very welcome. She could say, the women would come to her and say, oh, we love you so much, you're so wonderful. And she says, yeah, great, great. And she says, but, yeah, that's great, but don't you dare disturb these men who are doing the spiritual practice. If you do, I'll kick you out, you know, of my, you won't be, you know, that's going to displease me. And they would say, oh, okay, I better not do that. Or, you know, and you might be able to control them somehow. I don't know. This is how I looked at it. Because men don't have any power anymore to control women in this world. By controlling, I mean keeping women from bossing them around. You know, if they want to do spiritual practice, now the woman says, hey, I'm the boss now. You can't do that anymore. You got to help us out with this this option that we've decided is that's what we want, and this is what you're going to be working on. This is literally the attitude of the modern young, especially young modern women, is you're going to do what we tell you to do, and we're not going to take any back talk whatsoever. So this is a complete disaster for the world. And I realized that. I said, wow, could I really stand up to the young women bossing people around? No, nobody can right now, because legally they have all the power. All the power. And very mischievous. So Ananda My Ma was the great protector of spiritual practice in the world. There's no question, she did not allow any interference in it whatsoever. So that would be very welcome if that was what would what if that's what's to come of it, you know. I don't know anyone who's a more a greater advocate of protecting spiritual practice than she was. But on the other hand, you certainly don't want her to be a magnet to give these bossy women the idea that somehow they're infallible and they're justified in their bossiness. And that would be the negative side of it. You know, that would be terrible. You know, but if that was the case, then, you know, we'd just have to get help on this issue from some other source, you know. I don't know. So how it might play out, it's hard to say, because it seems as though, like, women in spirituality have gotten this, you know, egoic complex that they're somehow supposed to be in control now, and they try to justify it through, you know, various ways, through spiritual female gurus and various things like that. But what they're doing is they're insisting that we take this lesser terrible option, that we shortchange ourselves. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that. So if this is a legitimate Ananda My Ma, a legitimate guru, then we'll have to see. We'll have to see if this is the case. I'm not going to jump to conclusions. Or is this just a, you know, the fake goddess who is a deceiver and misleads? This is the question. So she might be running interference for those in the world who want to do, you know, genuine spiritual practice, such as myself. I feel that's necessary here, actually. If we want to take true refuge, you have to be protected from these very militant, aggressive, Amazonian, bossy, whore of Babylon attitude young women in the world. There's so many of them. These are the women that the young men say, wow, look out for these. They're bad news. Very, very bad. This is the reports I've gotten, and I've seen it. You know, they just look at you like, I mean, there's no respect of an elder man, a dignified person, respectable elder man, you know, no respect whatsoever, laughing, talking, cavorting, just like, I mean, the way they behave is just unbelievable. It's like we're in control. Nothing else matters. Nothing else matters. You're under our spell. You know, you have no esteem, no respect, no respect for the elders, no respect. Said the world belongs to us. You're under our spell. We'll do it whatever we want to with you. This is the attitude they have. Like they're the attitude of someone who's just, you know, giddy with total, you know, world control power, giddy with it. They're giddy. I said, what the heck's going on here? And when someone acts with great respect, it's completely different. You say, wow, that's the way things used to be. And there's nobody who acted with more respect than Ananda My Ma, there's no question about it. So we'll see. If someone shows up like that, you can tell by the respect, the attitude that they have. It won't be that difficult to tell if such a situation. They would have, you know, true, genuine respect for elder people, men and women who have been on the spiritual path and worked as hard as I have. She would have a profound respect for that, and you would be able to tell in her attitude for sure. So I guess there's nothing to worry about, you know. It's in discernment, as far as discernment goes. Now, I was told that she would return, but I feel an usurper tried to convince me that they were her return, you know, tried to jump the gun, so to speak, and eventually saw through that. And I said, no, you're not it. You're just trying to convince me that you are, and so get me to work for you. So that doesn't mean that the genuine article won't show up. It may just be that, you know, if like someone, you know, you hear like false Jesuses, you know, we know Jesus is going to surface very soon. He's already back, but he hasn't surfaced yet. And there may be, you know, there's many in the world who may be saying that, yeah, I'm the Jesus. Come follow me. We have that bloke in Oz, you know, Ozzy, you know, I can't remember his name. him and Mary Magdalene, her, you know, they say, I'm Jesus, you know, and there's a guy, some guy in Puerto Rico or Brazil, or they, you know, they're surfacing Russia, they're saying, yeah, I'm Jesus, and so people say, oh, Jesus is coming back soon, and here's someone saying he's Jesus, so maybe this is it, so maybe we'll go and work for him and glorify him and stuff. Same thing happened with Ananda. My mom, I was told, I believe she told me that she is returning at the same time that Jesus is going to return, and since Jesus is already back, this would be the time now, and to help out. And then someone else, a usurper, suddenly grabbed my attention. I was aware of this, and they made me think that they were really Ananda Maima. I needed to work for them, and so this is what dragged me through the mud so badly. But that doesn't mean that Ananda Maima is not coming back. It doesn't mean that. It just means that this dynamic is present in the world of usurpation by the ego, by continuity fear. So it was my own continuity fear suddenly leaping up and saying, no, you know, you need to serve me. You need to serve the continuity fear. You need to serve this lesser option, you know, of making pretense permanent. So I understand this. I understand this. I'm not very happy about it, to say the least. You know, I just think, wow, that was really a rough go there. But I'm, you know, once burned, twice shy, but I it would be hard to fake Ananda Maima to me. It would be pretty doggone difficult, because it would be the respect, you know, that you'd see, and she would show that respect in public to everybody, and the young woman would see that, you know, and they're just saying, what the heck is she doing? You know, I mean, you know, that's not our attitude. So it would be this profound attitude. And a usurper couldn't fake that. They couldn't fake that. There'd be some mischievousness in them that would come out. It would come to the surface. It would come to the surface. So I've been struggling with this today, because I did have that dream where suddenly Ananda Maima emerged, surfaced. She suddenly surfaced. It was in my dream, and you know, I was thrilled. I said, wow. This is tremendously good news, but then I also am very, very much, you know, cautioned to say, you know, wow, you know, the continuity fear would like nothing better than to usurp this, you know, and turn our attraction towards that, in the direction of serving the continuity fear's objective, which is to make pretense permanent. So I'm just like, well, you know, we'll have to see. I mean, that would be a great addition to the team. You know, I mean, she'd be able to, you know, right now it takes a woman to handle women. I mean, men have no chance right now. Women are absolutely out of their drunk on the blood of the saints, as which the whores of Babylon, and they have the upper hand in existence anyway, in this dream, over men. Sometimes they choose not to use it because they find it to their advantage, but if they want to, it's like a bank putting a loan out, and the person thinks they own the home, but the bank can call in the note any time. The bank says, no, I don't want to. I get more money if I just keep charging interest. But if the bank could foreclose and say, hey, wait a minute, we've decided that you've got to pay everything now, or whatever. It's a clause in there. And then they throw you out of your house. If they wanted to, they could. And it's the same way with women, females. They have the power over men. They really do. And if they want to, they can put men down. They absolutely can. And this is what they're planning to do. They're planning to use the power to market this very inferior option to the world, which is to keep pretending that we're really human and make that pretending permanent, automated. So this is a very important issue. I mean, I haven't talked about this dream because I was like, whoa, wait a minute. You know, I have once burned, twice shy. Is this the genuine article, or, you know, is this the usurper? Because definitely someone jumped up and tried to usurp this, get my attention, saying, hey, I'm really Ananda Maima. And gradually I realized, no, it's a usurper. It's a usurper. And he said, well, I'm getting you ready for her. I said, no, you're not. You're just trying to get me to glorify you, which is just the goddess of this new world religion. Goddess of this new world religion of, you know, glorifying the humanness. Ananda Maima said she never ever identified with the body, even for one instant. Has zero value to her. Zero. That's a real guru. So, this could either be great good news or not. But I'm just calm about it, you know. It's like whatever, you know, whatever it turns out to be, I'm not going to see it any other way. And until it's whatever, you know, whatever is proven is proven. Whatever is proven is proven. If someone wants to prove themselves, then let it be. It is what it is. And of course, this guru had the power to protect all her devotees totally from any harm whatsoever. Super guru, an absolute super guru. I think the greatest guru there's ever been in the world, actually, as far as demonstrating complete palette, the complete palette, absolute complete palette, could paint with every single color of guru-ness possible. So it'll be, you know, be a very welcome addition. That, you know, doesn't overshadow what Jesus is doing, nor Longchenpa, nor Ramana Maharshi. They all supplement one another. They're all very important. But getting help with this female factor would be very, very helpful. Yeah, many instances that the women just tried to dominate her, and they said, men aren't allowed here, men can't do this, men can't do this. She had this clique around her, very aggressive females, and they tried to boss her around, and they said, you can't, you know, men can't do this, men aren't allowed here, men tried to, you know, and she'd always find ways to get around, circumvent that, disappear, she'd disappear, and she'd find ways to make sure the men were not dominated in that way. And when the women tried to stand up to her, she'd, you know, go into some catatonic state, and they'd scare the heck out of them, you know, and they'd say, okay, sorry. And they'd back off a little bit, you know. It just shows you that women, you know, think that they're the ones running things here in the world, and they feel they're entitled to, then, you know, that she belongs, the great guru belongs to them, because they want her to do what they feel, you know, that they have the right to shape the world the way they want to, so the guru should be working for them. You know, they wanted to build ashrams and hospitals and buildings and politics, and, you know, they wanted to make India the, you know, the mother nation of all worlds, and this was very strong. And she refused to do any of that. She said, I'm sorry, but I can't help you with that. Yeah, but they kept trying. So she's great at running interference in that way. There's no question about it. So I'd welcome that. I'd absolutely welcome that. If that's to be. We need interference. There's no question. We need sanctuary. We need refuge. We need someone to run interference, because the women are just out of their minds right now. God, you know, not every single one of you. Those of you watching the view, of course, not every single one. We have to speak in generalities. We're speaking about the broad picture, pun intended, which is, you know, this is the way it is right now. Now, I know there are a lot of women that would love to run interference for men and help them out, but they're not able to. This is the trouble. You need like a superwoman to do it. I know a lot of women have tried to protect men from this onslaught that's been going on. And they've been crushed, you know. And I thank every single last one of them for the effort. There's no doubt about it. They try to say, hey, wait, this isn't fair, this isn't right, wait a minute, you know, let men have their say. Hey, they, you know, they're very important too. They're very good at reason, they're very good at sustained, focused, you know, intent, endeavor. Let them do their prayers, let them have the spiritual path. Stop trying to, you know, undermine them. And but these other women are just out of their minds with, you know, they're drunk on their delusional, you know, on the continuity fear, drunk on the continuity fear. You know, they're Shiva, you know, dancing the dance of destruction out of their minds. Now, none of my mind can scare the living daylights out of them in a good way. I mean, if they try to, you know, contravene, you know, her will and do something that's not right, I mean, she can literally drop dead and start rotting right in front of their eyes. She did it before, and that scared the heck out of them. And they said, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, we're sorry, we'll never do that again, never do that again. And then, poof, she came back to life as fresh as a daisy. Just like that. So this is not somebody that you mess with, you know, in terms of trying to attack her devotees. Now, she won't harm anyone, but she'll let them know that, you know, who's the boss. I mean, you know, don't mess with the spirit, those on the spiritual path. Don't mess with them. Now, it seems like too little too late. You know, there's another big complaint I have. You know, if she said she was coming back in 1997, didn't come, you know, that should have come back then. I mean, right now, I think it's too late for a lot of us, you know? This is frustrating. But we'll leave the timing up to God, you know, the Holy Spirit. I cannot, you know, authoritatively say anything about it one way or the other because, you know, the issue is too complex to, you know, to really, for me to discern exactly. You know, it may be that they had to wait until this marketing campaign got underway so we could give our final decision which we were going to go. Otherwise, we might have felt that they were being unfair to us and trying to boss us around. That's possible. That's why Jesus hasn't come back yet, too, in terms of surfacing. He's already back, but he hasn't surfaced. Maybe he says, I got to wait until this other marketing campaign for this other option gets underway this week. So that you can decide which way am I going to go without feeling that I'm pressuring you, and just let your reason tell you. So I've already confirmed, you know, I'm going with the greater option, and so, you know, I don't feel pressured. I don't feel they're pressuring me at all. If they showed up, I wouldn't say that they're trying to influence or pressure me at all. I just say, well, you're gonna help us here, great, but I've already decided that this is the way to go. That what the Holy Spirit has shown me is the way to go. That we can stop pretending. We can stop pretending. I know it's true, we can. So that's where I'm going. So if these great teachers show up, you know, I'll just, you know, say, well, welcome, you know. I hope you can help out a lot. But I don't feel that they're influencing my decision. I worked it out with the Holy Spirit by using reason. Gave a fair hearing to the whole situation, said there really is a way. We really can do right spiritual practice. We really can. This word practice really works, and so we can set our pretending down ultimately. Absolutely we can, and ultimately we have to. So, you know, going the other direction is just delay. It's just going to be massive delay is all it is. And what good is massive delay? It's no good at all. It's useless. So we'd just be wandering around aimlessly is all we'd be doing. You know, I stopped working on the pictures of an onto my mind. I realized that's not it. I mean, you really going to show those to the whores of Babylon and say, hey, look, she's got our back. They're going to just laugh at you and say, really, where is she? I don't see her. You know, you're going to do what we tell you to do. You're going to accept this lesser option. You know, what can you do? Nothing. But if the real McCoy is here, it's a whole different story. They'll stop dead in their tracks. They'll back off and say, whoa. I don't think we can handle this lady. Their mischief will go somewhere else, that is for sure. But the proof is in the pudding. You know, the proof is in the pudding. You know, we'll see. We'll see how we're helped. You know, I'm very low-key about it because the path has been so difficult. So many promises. You know, we'll reflect on it in hindsight in terms of being too laudatory, you know. Let's wait until we get the beef. You know, where's the beef, as I have said? I'm saying, hey, Holy Spirit, where's the beef? You know, all these promises of help. You know, where's now? We most definitely need the help now. This week is the pivotal point in the entire history here on the planet Earth. So where's the beef? Well, on Sunday, I think it was Sunday, or Saturday night, maybe it was Saturday, all this beef was delivered to where we live. a whole big case, a big cardboard box full of beef was delivered, you know, here. I said, what? You know, where'd this, are you kidding me? All this beef. our freezer is now just full of all this beef. So the Holy Spirit must be saying, you want the beef, here comes the beef. We actually grilled some beef yesterday on a Foreman grill, and actually fired up the outdoor barbecue today, the first time in a long time. It had a gas leak in the hose. I took the hose off and I checked it, and son of a gun, it's all cracked, and it was leaking gas. So I went on down, I bought a new barbecue hose, and it's all good, and no more leaking. Barbecue's ready to go. I'll throw all those patties on there. So, you know, it's so extraordinary. Nothing like this has ever happened in my life, that someone brings home a you know, what do you call it, filing cabinet size, you know, one of those cardboard boxes, which is, you know, like about, you know, a banker's box. It's like the size of a banker's box, cardboard box, full of frozen beef and some salmon too. Here's the beef. But asking, but where's the beef? Here's the beef. We got the beef, is coming your way this week, you know, this week, party time. And, you know, I was just like, where were I? Just going around in stores, just marketing, doing whatever, just moving around through stores, and this is a culture in general. You know. I mean, I suddenly realized, am I in a strip club or what? I mean, every woman you see is dressed like she should be in a strip club. It's absolutely crazy. Absolutely nuts. The young women too. I mean, it's the way the mothers dress their children is just completely scandalous. What are they raising them up to be, strippers? It certainly seems that way. Crazy. It just hit me, you know. What? And in a church, too. The church is the ridiculous Catholic church. I mean, a lot of the women actually do dress appropriately, the older women. But the younger ones, heck no. Heck no. Come in with ripped short shorts and you know, midriff tank tops and all this. I mean, just total, I mean, stripper attire. And I said, man, that is just hideous for men. Absolutely hideous. It's extraordinarily undermining, you know, our focus. It's exploiting us, you know, very exploitive. You talk about exploitation. That's severe exploitation. So this is not something a non-to-my-mom would put up with at all. Not put up with that in the slightest regard. She is extremely strict with those who came to see her. Extraordinarily strict. Extreme modesty. She had so many rules. She was very strict. But people put up with her. Put up with that because she's also, you know, divinely loving and kind and respectful. But no, you didn't get away with that. But if you're a man now and you try, I feel like I want to speak up and say, I say, hey, what the hell do you think you are? Is a strip club or something? I want to speak up to these women. You can't do that. They'll have you jailed. if you even say that. Don't dare say anything like that. Used to be men could say that. Absolutely they could. And other women too. They'd see a child dressed up. I say, you know, who dressed you that way? How dare you be dressed that way? Of course, it used to be that children were raised in community in the United States, small towns or community, where everybody took part in raising the children. And you'd go to any house at all, and they'd treat you like they were your parents, and they'd admonish you. It wasn't just your own parents that would admonish you. Every adult in that town could admonish every child in that town. And there was no problem at all. Now, if you did try to admonish someone else's child, you would be arrested. You'd be sued. This is insanity here in this world. So there'd always be various women in these towns in the United States. If you have a young woman dressing like a stripper, they'd say, go home this very instant and put on some decent clothes. Don't you dare show your face in public until you do that. And that was the end of it. And if they walked into a store that way, they wouldn't be served. If they walk in a restaurant, they would not be served. They'd say, get out of my, the owner would say, get out of my store. This isn't some strip club. This isn't some whorehouse. Get out of my store. Don't come back until you're dressed decently. And you think the parents would like get upset and sue these people? Hell no. Excuse my French. Heck no. They'd say, how dare you walk into a store like that? I'll disown you as my daughter if you ever go into public dressed that way. And they couldn't show their face in public if they tried to dress that way. That's how it used to be just 40 years ago, 50 years ago. That's how much the world has been subverted. That's how much it's been subverted. They say, how dare you try to disrespect men in that way? It's extraordinarily disrespectful. So, we'll see. We'll see if, you know, is it the divine grace that shows up, or the goddess, the whore of Babylon, chief goddess that shows up? Well, we'll find out. We'll find out. It seems like something is going to happen very soon. And even male, gurus, teachers here, they don't have this, the women. The women could come to, let's say have satsang. They can come dressed any way they want to, and you cannot say you don't dare come here. They say it's discrimination, sexism. That you're harassing them, they're based on the way they're dressed. It's a sexual harassment. They'd sue you. They'd sue you. I mean, you're not Kleiner Perkins with, like, $1 trillion who can hire the best lawyers in the world to debunk some feminist claim that she was sexually harassed. And then when she lost, that she says, we're going to go after and appeal it, and we're going to get, and then finally she dropped it and said, I need to move on with my life. Yeah, right. Didn't have a strong case. It's likely that was, fabricated, likely fabrication. And she just thought she could win. They would cave. They would cave. They didn't cave. Kleiner Perkins didn't cave because they can afford the best lawyers in the world. But everyone thought they would cave. Like the extraordinarily venture capital company, extraordinarily powerful in the Silicon Valley. And this sexual harassment lawsuit, they won it. They went, to the trial. They won it, but still, the threat of appeal, you thought that they might just she wanted their all her attorney fees and a bunch of settlement, blah, 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 blah. And we thought they'd cave, but they didn't cave. Because they knew that they could win it. Their lawyers told them, we can win this. But the average person, there's no chance. There's no chance. You're going to get crushed. Kleiner Perkins might be one of the few companies left in the world that wouldn't be crushed by such a situation. Almost every other corporation would probably settle, would have settled. But of course, I don't know if they'll pursue it any further of damaging their reputation. It was very damaging their reputation, right, as a place to work. women would say, "Wow, I don't want to work there," and men would say, "Well, I don't want to work there because women don't want to work there," and they look badly at me if I work there. "You work at Kleiner Perkins? It's a sexual harassment, plus it's not friendly to women. You know, how can you work there?" So it's extremely detrimental to the image of a company to have any sort of sexual harassment lawsuit, even though it's completely may be fabricated or extremely embellished. In the give and take of workplace, all sorts of intensity happens, but it can be extraordinary. It can be pieced together, cherry-picked, embellished, spun this way and that way, and they feel that the law is going to go over them and say, "Oh, that sounds like it's pretty plausible, so this is the way things are going." So it doesn't even matter if you're a spiritual guru. I don't really think that you can really protect yourself truly here. I don't know. It doesn't seem that way. Maybe you could if you're a perfect guru. Yeah, I guess you could, because you choose everything that happens to you entirely. So yeah, if you were perfect, like if you were Jesus, then yeah, you cannot. Nothing would be able to touch you. That is true. But we're not there yet. So we need protection. We need protection. And women that also are on the same page need protection too, because they'll also get crushed. I mean, these whores of Babylon will go after them too, very severely. I mean, if you just try to be a woman, try to keep these young women in line and find out what happens to you. They're ruthless. They're very ruthless. They seem to be unaware, of their destiny. They're drunk on the wine of the blood of the saints, so to speak, that they think they have power now, that they have power over everybody on the planet. So it will come as a severe shock to them if it should be that we do have some great teachers here, that they don't have power over those great teachers. This will be an extraordinary shock to them. Now, I talked about this young maiden, the activist that probably was promoting the New World Order agenda, probably climate change or something like that, and was coming up here, and I was outside taping here, and she saw me, and I saw her, and I said, I'm working here, and I can't entertain you right now." And she was shocked, look a shock on her face. She was like very startled and shocked. Then she just turned around and just left like that. In other words, she's totally unused to that sort of response. Totally unused to it. She's totally used to everybody giving their time of day. At least, hi, what are you here for? Oh, really? Okay, wow, it's nice that you're doing this. And for me to just say, "No, I'm working here. I can't entertain you right now." Stunned her. Absolutely stunned her. They're just not used to that at all. And so, but this is what you have to say in a spiritual situation where you're focusing in on the option that you really want. You say, "I can't entertain the other option. There's no way, because I'll lose sight. It's so difficult here to stay focused on the option that we really want. We cannot be disturbed and undermined. It's too difficult." This is something Ananda Maima certainly knows. It's very difficult here to stay focused on it. This entire universe, you might say, is dedicated to not even seeing it at all, saying it doesn't exist, to be blind to it. So you're trying to regain your sight, and then you're getting saying, "Hey, wait a minute, you need to talk with us and give us time of day and let us present our thing." No, we don't. We already know what it's all about. We know it's a futile dead end. We don't want to give you any time of day at all. We've already given you billions of years, this option, billions of years, whatever long, right? We don't have to give it another instant. We don't owe it another instant. But how do you assert this unless you might have a den mother asserting it for you? Saying, "Hey, don't mess with these guys. I don't deserve you the time of day. You want to mess with somebody, mess with me." Yeah, I'm just hoping for the best case scenario here. We certainly deserve it. We certainly deserve the best, actually. I feel I absolutely deserve the best. I know everybody does. They just don't, may not realize it. They may not be willing to assert it. They're too afraid to assert it, that they deserve the best. They deserve this, the best option. I absolutely know I deserve the best option. There's no doubt about it whatsoever. But trying to assert it in the world is a different story. You might back down. I could back down if enough pressure is brought to bear. Here, absolutely everybody could back down, except these perfect teachers. They cannot back down. They won't back down. That is a fact. It's interesting. I remember talking with Jesus in a dream, and I was talking about a band. I said, "What kind of band?" I wasn't sure whether he said just three in the band, or I just need three others, just three more. That's it. Only three more. And it could have been that, which would be interesting because there would be four. It would be Jesus, Rana Maharshi, Longchampa, and Anamayama. That's the four that I would be aware of. That seem to be heavily involved in this end time scenario. These are four super gurus, actually. Absolute super teachers, super saviors, you might call them. Every single one of them is. I mean, you can't take anything away from any one of those four whatsoever. Absolutely not. It's not possible. They would have our backs. They would have the backs of those who are trying to see, to go with the option that we really want. And ultimately the option that everyone has to go for eventually. There's no choice in whatsoever. We cannot make pretense permanent. Because we are spirit, and spirit is absolutely free every moment. So it's free to stop pretense every single moment. So how could we say we made it permanent? It is absolutely impossible to do this. In fact, we never even take the first step to making it permanent. We've never even taken the first step. So we've never even taken one step towards making it permanent. Okay, we're spirit, we're perfectly free forever. Therefore, at any instant, we could stop pretending. We have a complete freedom to stop all pretense, any instant. Therefore, how could we ever take even one step to making pretense permanent? Therefore, how can this be a truly viable option to make pretense permanent? How can that be anything but utter nonsense? And yet we're free to imagine that it is an option, even though it's really just an imaginary, silly, construct, mental construct. But for the sake of talking about, we'll call it an option, right? But let's be clear about it. It's option zero. We can't even take one step in that direction. Though we think we've taken many, we haven't. As Jesus says, I've just been aimlessly wandering about without any purpose whatsoever, just aimlessly wandering about. That's all there is we've been doing. It's all that we've been doing. Haven't eaten much today. A couple of bags of Doritos. Got those free, so I said, okay. Sun-kissed orange juice, a can of sun-kissed orange juice I also got for free. And a little bit of grapefruit juice and fage yogurt, little cup of fage yogurt with blueberry jam. And that's it. That's all I've had today. A little couple pieces of tofu, leftovers. So going light on the food right now. It feels good. 103 degrees today in the Bay Area. It was a cooker for sure. Loved it. I was passing out Gatorade. Tomorrow is supposed to drop way down, 85. It's going to drop 18 degrees. I don't know how that's possible. It's very, very warm right now. it doesn't say any fog's coming in. I don't know, but you know, they've been doing pretty good, the weather forecasting recently. So I believe that it's going to drop. So we're being realistic, pragmatic, and we're also being hopeful here. We're going to get some help, you know. We're not just going to leave ourselves with just some numbers here. We're talking about major significant possibilities of help here. Oh, something that also very interesting happened. I think it was like day before yesterday. It was like maybe Saturday or a few days ago that I lost a memory chip, a 32 gigabyte memory chip. And when my camera broke, you know, I eventually had to throw it away, the camera. And I couldn't find this memory chip anywhere. I went through everything. Twice, three times. I said, my gosh, it must have been in the camera I threw away. I said, that's amazing how sloppy I was. I can't believe I did that. I just can't believe it. But I know I put the chip right here. It has to be right here, and it's not here. So I'm bringing my laptop into the desk, and the laptop case is there. And I'm going to put the laptop in the case and after I finish taping. And right there, right in the middle, on the bottom of the case, right there, plain view, there's the memory chip. And I say, how is that possible? I searched this case over and over and over and over and over. Not a trace of it. And now it's just sitting right there in the middle. Right there in plain view. I cannot explain it at all. But there it was. A memory showing up, something that was used to be just a memory, it shows up. I don't know. Interesting, right? So I'm trying to give an option here to the horrible doomsdayness of the internet and how they're just, they don't give you any hope, really hope. You know, it's just like, oh, I hope Jesus, you know, we're all raptured. Well, I mean, really? I mean, we're all know exactly what that's about and where we're going and how to adapt to it. And we know, you know, really, you know, we're all ready for it. Well, and here's another aside, very interesting. I suddenly started doing all this stuff just automatically, not even thinking about it, but preparing for some sort of natural catastrophe, you know, getting all the gasoline, the propane, you know, the barbecue ready. We got all that beef, just things that you would do in case there happened to be like some natural disaster, like an earthquake or whatever. Earth gets hit by meteorites or whatever. I just suddenly started doing all this stuff just automatically. I was just like, wow. Oh, the generator. Fixing the generator. Need to be fixed. I hope I fixed it. I'm not sure. But trying to get the generator, make sure the generator's working. Stuff like this. It's a good time. It's a good time to make sure you know you have your generator's working. If you have one and you've got some fuel to run the generator, you've got propane to cook with, to heat with, to light with, you know, and various things like that. Got some LED light bulbs which will last. You can leave them on all constantly, and they last for supposed to last 25 years, 25,000 hours actually. That'd be 1,000 hours a year. How many day? That would be like 3 hours a day, basically on, right? 1,000 hours, 3 hours a day. But if you left it on all day, 24 hours, 1,000, 24, that would go 40 days. Oh, it only lasts 40 days if you leave it on all day. That's not that much, is it? I mean, that cuts that. I think that's right. Is that right? Or 25,000. No, it would be 40 times 25, I think. Which would be about 1,000 days, something like that. Maybe I got it all wrong. Or maybe even like 3,000 days. 3 and 24 is 8, so 3 times 8 is 24. So divide 25,000 hours by 8. Because we got 3 hours a day, that'd be 25 years. So divide it by 8, and it would leave you with about 3,000. So maybe 3,000 days, you left it on constantly. Which would be quite a time, I don't know. No, 3,000. No, it'd be 3 years. I'm sorry. 25 years, 3 years. I don't know what I'm talking about. 3,000 hours. 3,000 hours. It would be 3,000 hours. It'd be 3,000 hours or something. Oh, my God. It's too much. Too much for me. Forget about the numbers, right? Just a little humor here. Lighten the mood. Someone who's good at math could probably do a better job than I. I used to be good, but I got something more important to do. I don't want to be some human computer. I could have been some human computer. I was very good at adding numbers in my mind, but I said, forget it. It's not important. That's not going to save us. Numbers will not save us. It's easy. 24 hours in a day, 25,000 hours. Divide 24 into 25,000. You get 1,000 plus. So it would be 1,000 plus days, which is about, 3 years. So you could leave it on for probably about 3 years straight. I think that sounds right. Maybe it doesn't. I don't think I'm going to get it. I don't think I'm going to get it. At any rate, lighting, you don't have to worry. The idea of LED, you can just leave on it for a long time. You don't have to worry. It takes very little energy also. Doesn't pull a lot of juice. So extreme small amount of energy. You could have, if you have a generator, you could have a whole string of LED lights providing a whole bunch of light, actually. If LEDs, it pulls such a tiny amount of electricity. And it wouldn't, you could run a lot of other things off the generator at the same time. Refrigerator, whatever. And refrigerator is a problem, right? Storing food. That's the big issue. be nice to have an energy, you know, energy efficient refrigerator, which we don't have. But that wouldn't last long anyway. I mean, how long can you run your generator? You know, you have to save it for beef jerky. I'm thinking beef jerky is a good thing to have. We don't have any, I don't think. Maybe tomorrow I'll get a bunch of beef jerky. It's not a bad thing. I mean, it's not a bad week to get stuff, you know. Just remind yourself, hey, these are the end times we're in. So beef jerky, you know, it's dry. It might last for years, you know. It's just, and it's protein. Seeds and nuts and stuff, but beef jerky, you can walk with it. You can put in a backpack full of beef jerky. You can probably walk across the country. Just some water and some beef jerky. I'd have to, you know, stop being a vegetarian at that point if I did that. And of course, in California, we know the earthquakes are going to come eventually. We've been through a long period with no earthquakes. And there's certainly, at some point, you know, we got something in Chile popping. At some point, you know, big earthquakes going to hit here. There's no question about it. There's zero question about it. We just hope it doesn't hit in our lifetime. But, you know, a lot of them have hit in my lifetime. Not the big one. Last really big one was 1906, San Francisco quake. Well, no, I mean, the Loma Prieta quake was what was it, 6.8, 7.1 or something. That was big. That was big. It collapsed the Cypress overpass in Oakland, you know, collapsed the Bay Bridge. It did a lot. It collapsed buildings in the Marina District, San Francisco. It did a tremendous damage. Did tremendous damage. But not like 1906 quake, which was, you know, 8 something plus, you know, it was really big. Because remember, earthquake measurements are exponential. So, you know, an 8 is way more powerful than a 7. So we're just cooling along here, right? Understanding the wow factor. This is what we do here. People who don't understand the wow factor and wonder what the heck we're doing here, blah, 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 chit-chatting along like this, bringing in all this stuff. It's simply to help us with the wow factor. I already brought up some stuff in this video that are just extraordinary. So we're just kind of, you know, making sure that the wow factor doesn't submerge us. See, the weird thing about the social structure of the world is very strange, but it's true. You bring in a man to a room full of strong women, and they wouldn't even pay any slightest attention to the man. No attention whatsoever. They would just go on doing exactly what they'd been doing, and no influence whatsoever. You bring a woman into a room of strong men, and she can end up controlling that whole room. They all change their behavior. They all get a little bit nervous, they'll change their behavior. Oh, you know, it's amazing. So this is totally, you know, different. It just shows you the power that women have. The men suddenly become self-conscious, you know, self-conscious. Whereas the women, you bring a man into a room full of women, they don't become self-conscious. Don't even pay any attention, don't even exist. So that's trouble. It's big trouble. Very difficult. You can't get all self-conscious when you're doing spiritual practice. You cannot get into that self-conscious mode at all. Scientist in the UK, a very famous, powerful scientist, got fired, had to resign, because he said, hey, you know, it's difficult to do science when there's all these women in the laboratory, you know, because they all want a relationship with you, they're all pursuing relationships with you. You know, that's the number one thing, ahead of science. He says, it's very distracting, it's very difficult to do science, pure science. And he's absolutely right. And of course, he's instantly, you know, put into the meat grinder. He probably drove him straight to CERN and threw him on the collider, you know. The Hadron Collider. Yeah. Just dumped him off at CERN headquarters and says, here you go, here's your test subject. Send him through a black hole. You know, this is what we're sending out from the Earth and let's see what comes back. That's why we haven't heard of him since, right? You know, maybe they'll fire up CERN on September 23rd, you know, and make a black hole happen. Maybe some meteorites will come out of the black hole. You wouldn't put it past them, right? A bunch of Faustian magicians there, huh? Euroscientists are always a little bit eccentric, you know, in my opinion. I think the cowboy mentality of America is a good thing for the world, you know? It really is. Still got a little bit of common sense here. I'll take a cowboy mentality over any of those scientists at CERN, I'll tell you that. The cowboys say, hey, you know, what do we need to be messing with, you know, trying to punch black holes anyway? I mean, I think that's probably a good idea to just shut this down. I mean, you know, scientists say, well, you know, if we should be able to do any experiment we want to do. You know, if there's something we can try, then we have a right to try it. That's nonsense. And they're trying to do all sorts of nasty stuff, and we shouldn't allow that. Shouldn't go along with it. They don't have a blank check from society, but the way they're running things, they act as though they do, and then they get away with it. They shouldn't be getting away with it. They need some, you know, nun to, you know, slap their knuckles with a ruler, actually. You know, but I mean, I talked to a lot of guys that went through Catholic school. And, oh boy, were they scared of the nuns! I'm telling you, those nuns were tough, ruthless. Talk about corporal punishment! Holy cow! Same with the priests and whatever. You know, absolutely, you messed up. Corporal punishment is on its way. Go kneel on the corner on a bunch of rice grains or something, right? I mean, after, you know, half an hour, your knees are just killing you. They got good stories of Catholic school, how it used to be. But they said, you know what? It sure molded me into understanding right from wrong. And I've never heard anybody say, you know, they really, in retrospect, that they regretted it. You know, they say, I was a real mischievous kid, and I messed up a lot, and they set me straight. So this is the way. You need to respect others, you need to respect society, you need to respect, you know, every culture, etc. And they got their point, you know, they made their point. Nowadays, I mean, this generation's been raised up basically where, you know, they can sue their parents for anything. So they're just a wild, undisciplined, disrespectful, mischievous generation. Don't respect their elders at all. I mean, how can you raise children when the parents are terrified that they're going to be sued if they say anything to the child? They go tell their teacher. The teachers now become the parents. The teachers become the mother. Hey, mommy, look what my parents did. They didn't let me watch the television show. They tell me probably the Holy Spirit said that's not a good idea. Mommy, teacher, what are you going to do about it? Oh, God, we're going to send social services over there right away. Are you kidding me? That's child abuse. So we have this generation who are used to terrorizing their elders, their parents. And you can tell they don't have any respect for their elders at all, their parents. You can just tell none. Now, someone just told me today, their child, they can't control it at all, can't do anything. They do whatever they want to do. They come home when they want to come home. They just leave home when they want to leave. They don't even tell them with the parents where they are. Parents can't do anything. Crazy. And so this is the culture that is going to be selling the world on this New World Order agenda. Aren't we lucky? Wow, they're really going to solve all our problems, aren't they? Yeah. And so they're not used to taking no for an answer. I mean, no doesn't, elder people saying no to them has never happened to them, basically doesn't exist. They're totally used to being coddled, and all the elders just groveling in front of them, saying, oh, please don't call social services, don't, sick the bureaucracy on me, don't sue me, don't get me in trouble, don't get me in trouble. It used to be the kids are afraid of the parents because the kids would do bad stuff and they know, I'm going to get in trouble. Now, it's the parents that are afraid of the kids. The kids are going to get the parents in trouble. Well, we know that's not a good idea. But the stupid, you can call them whatever you want, those who support this nonsense, have led us into this very, very bad situation. So we'll take all the support from the great teachers that we can get, every last bit of it. Come on down. Come on down. Let's see how the bureaucracy can tangle with them. Let's see what happens then. I tell you, they're gonna be like a shark biting on some titanium or something. Someone made out of titanium. The shark says, "Here's someone to bite, and chomp." And they're in a very chompy mood right now. All these squirrels jumping around the world, very chompy mood indeed. And let's see them chomp onto Anandamayama, for instance, and see what happens to their teeth when they get real chompy, and see how chompy they feel after that. Nothing like a shark biting into a steel cage or something steel, They say, I got a toothache. I think all my teeth ache right now. I got a jaw ache. There's little spiders going up and down. Itsy bitsy spider, up and down. This is actually an itsy bitsy little spider going up and down, up and down, up and down. It's enjoying its life, I hope. Or maybe it's saying, why am I going up and down like this constantly? I don't get it. Something's telling me to do this, but I just feel it's kind of stupid. Yeah. There's no question that the generations, the people under 30, so to speak, are feeling very chompy right now. They're in a very chompy mood. You can feel it. They're like sharpening their knives and their teeth and saying, I'm ready to bite in. I'm ready to bite into everybody. Get their crocodile on. T-Rex, here comes T-Rex, I love that they got all these T-Rex decals on cars now. They feel very T-Rexy. So, hey, Rexy, try to chomp onto my mouth. Let's see what happens to your jaw. The first time you see T-Rex cry tears, huh? You're gonna need a bucket to collect the tears.
Well, I got a terrible toothache and my jaw aches. My God, I don't feel very good. I'm a sad T-Rex. You can go sit over in a corner and pout. You know, a T-Rex is sitting over in a corner just... I don't feel so good. I don't feel so chompy anymore. my T-Rex image is blown. I don't feel chompy at all, as a matter of fact. I think I'm going to become a vegetarian.
Yeah, we got so many dinosaur decals and motifs in the world now. It's just insane. So much T-Rexy stuff, which is supposed to be, you know, the most fearsome chompiness ever. Although they've come up with another one they think that's a little more chompy. And this is designed to intimidate. It's designed to be intimidate, so yeah. Let T-Rex try to chomp on Jesus' hand or something, you know. It's going to get a big surprise. Or she. I don't know if T-Rex is a he or a she. But I do know that they T-Rex considers itself to be very chompy. Yeah, big bad dinosaurs, huh? Big bad reptiles. Ready to chomp us up. If we don't do what they say, well, chomp away. It's just a chomp away. Your toothache is just a chomp away. Give me shelter. It's just a... Give me a headache. It's just a chomp away. Yeah, you're gonna have this like rehab facility for all these chompy T-Rexes, you know. That they're learning how to be vegetarians, you know. They're very polite in their little hands like this, you know. They're eating their chickpeas, you know, and their curry, and they say, "Yum yum, that tastes so good. I really like it. How do you make curry like that? It's awesome." You got the saffron in there too. Awesome vegetarian dish. Can I have tofu tomorrow night? You know, T-Rex says, can I have tofu tomorrow night? I love it, I love it, I love it. Yeah, rehab. We'll put them in rehab. Why not? They deserve rehab just like everyone else. Doesn't T-Rex deserve rehab? Of course T-Rex deserves rehab. Gotta get over those chompy habits. And I'm sure they would love to do so. Reposing a little cup of chamomile tea, sipping the tea. Ah, this is so great, this tea. I love this herbal tea. I'm even losing weight. I'm not so ponderous as I was before. That's very nice. I feel I'm kind of shrinking, you know. This is great. Maybe I can even shrink down to a less intimidating, chompy kind of appearance here. That would be nice. Yeah, aren't we having fun here? Isn't this better than reading these endless, you know, articles of doom, 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 doom? Nothing but doom. You're all toast. But at least I told you about it. You know, well, thanks, but it's kind of malicious, you know. If you don't have something positive, some way to give us some optimism and some hope, you know, it's kind of malicious. least on the Titanic, they could say, well, you know what? There's these lifeboats here. I think everybody, we might hit an iceberg, but there's all these lifeboats, so I suggest, you know, you get near the lifeboats and, you know, you give them some hope. You just don't say, guess about everybody on the Titanic, we're gonna sink and we're all gonna die. Oh, great, thank you for telling me that. And then they go right back to the bar and be drinking, you know, highballs. What? How do they call it, a highball? I don't know. A Manhattan. So we were super intense. We very tried to bring a lot of humor, a lot of lightheartedness into the most intense week in the history of the planet. We bring some hope, and we flip the script. You know, like we're looking at what if we did get help. Well, we're not afraid of T-Rexy anymore. In fact, we're having a good laugh with T-Rexy and imagining how nice rehab is going to be for you know all these chompers and. As they realize that they really, chomping isn't really their thing anymore. It's wonderful to flip the script that way and imagine what a beautiful world it would be if all these chompers were in rehab, serious rehab, and that'd be great. You know, all praise to that, all blessings to that. We're not viewing anyone as enemies. We're just seeing how can we get these folks who need rehab into rehab. That's all. Again, everyone has perfect standing with God. No one has any greater or lesser standing with God, and this standing can never be changed in any which way. So, you know, why spend time blaming and judging and hating and enemies and this and that? It's just say, how do we get everyone into rehab and evaporate the continuity fear and accept this option of we can end our pretense, set it down, and get with that and get it done. That's all we're thinking about here. That's all that we're looking at here. So we're very, very courageous to go into Monday of this week. You know, now into this video will be up on Tuesday. We're already into Tuesday. My God, the pontiff himself is arriving in the good old U.S. of A. Cowboy country. Where some people actually still have some common sense enough to say, wait a minute. Why is he addressing joint session of Congress again? I mean, refresh my memory. What was the reason he's doing that for? I'm not quite sure. Has it all been clarified for everyone? It's never been done before. No one's ever suggested it before. No Pope has ever addressed a joint session of Congress at all. And so it's happening now. Why? We're supposed to know the answer, but I kind of forgot. I'm sure it's been pasted over. It has been given out to the public 100 times by now, right? Exactly why he's doing this. I must have missed it somehow. I'm not sure why this is happening. Maybe if somebody knows, they can let us know why this is happening, why this has to happen, why this is important that it's happened. I mean, the joint session of Congress is the representatives that we send, that we, the cowboys of this country and cowgirls of this country, send to Washington to represent us and our interests. So what is the Pope doing addressing our representatives? Essentially, it's addressing us. That's a lot more intense than talking to the POTUS who... You know, who can, you know, they can always rig that election. They'll bust people here, bust people there, you know. They can jury rig an election if the president is possible. But Congress is a different story. There's so many, 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 many. They represent us at a grassroots roots level. There's a joint session of Congress, of representatives and senators. So why is the Pope addressing our representatives? Did we ask for that? Did we agree, say, hey, Pope, we want you to address us? Why? Were we asked, you know, were we consulted, we the people? Were we the people consulted on this? Maybe we should address the Pope, actually. Or actually the ex-Pope, Pope Emeritus. Maybe we should be the ones addressing the Pope. And said, you know, what kind of job are you doing for our salvation? Are you emphasizing the right option, the good option that we really want? Is that what you're emphasizing? Or are you emphasizing the humanist option, you know, the terrible non-option option that never gets anywhere, of making pretense permanent? Is that what you're emphasizing? I think we should ask the Pope a few questions. Pope, ex-Pope Emeritus Francis, I think we should ask Pope a few questions. As an apostle of Jesus, I'm doing that right now. You know, which option are you promoting? You can't promote both. To do so is nothing but promoting confusion, which doesn't help anyone. So which option are you promoting? This is a question. Don't need to ask really any other question. I mean, the answer to that question tells the story, doesn't it? We already know what option the president's pursuing. We think he's the president. There's no past. He has no past that anyone can really find. Really, very much. It's all been scrubbed. Pretty much what's only what's left is what they want you to see. Everything else has disappeared. Maybe they threw that into CERN too. They sent it all to CERN, all his high school yearbooks of his mom. They sent him to CERN and they threw those into a black hole too. I mean, the Pope, you know, the Pope should be black and white about the situation. This is what I'm supporting. Exactly, and this is exactly what I'm supporting. This is exactly why I'm supporting it. This is how I'm supporting it. There's no two ways about it. It's black and white. There's not going to need any some tap dance, you know? So he should be able to answer that easily and point it out completely obvious to everyone. Says, hey, this is what I stand for. This is what the church stands for. Cut and dried. There's no compromise whatsoever here. I don't need all this spiritual rhetoric. It's a very simple question. Which option? It's got trouble answering that. He's got no business being Pope. Pope should be able to say, absolutely 100% the option that we can give up pretense entirely. And I absolutely know that this is, we can do this and we must do it and we will do it. And from the standpoint of the Holy Spirit, we've already done it. It's already done deal. And this is the option I support. And I do not support the other option at all. Now, I understand pragmatism, and we're not mean-spirited about it, and so, you know, it may seem a little bit ragged to the world, etc., but it's crystal clear which option that I'm supporting and the church supports. It's absolutely crystal clear. There's no two ways about it whatsoever. That's what a pope should say. That should be the easiest thing in the world for a pope to say. That's what Jesus would say. And they're representing Jesus, right? They're saying this is what Jesus would say. Well, then they shouldn't have the slightest problem saying that. So maybe he's going to stand up in front of a joint session of Congress and say that. It's not going to waffle at all. Not going to try to be a humanist at all. Not going to try to even, you know, no, he's going to say, hey, look, this is the option that everyone has to ultimately choose. It's vastly superior option. The other option totally shortchanges us. It's terrible. It's a dead end. We can never take even one step to making pretense permanent or real. Therefore, I absolutely stand for the option of that we work on setting our pretense down. And there's a spiritual path and practice that enables us to do that. And the religion I stand for has those practices, has the right teaching, the right practice, the discipline, everything to lead us down this path and encourage us down this path so we can succeed in dropping all pretense altogether, ultimately. Should be able to stand up. Maybe that's exactly what the Pope is going to do, stand up in front of a joint session of Congress and say exactly that. And, you know, if he needs a transcript, he can use this transcript off this video for it. Yeah, it's Creative Commons. He can use this trance right out here. Take the words right out of my mouth. They're free. No copyright. Take the words. Declare in front of Congress what any Pope should declare. That should be your creed right there. Let that be your Aquarian creed right there. So maybe that's what he's going to do. Maybe that's why he's meeting the president. Maybe that's why he's addressing the United Nations too. He just wants to make it very clear what he stands for. That's what a Pope should do, right? Give him the benefit of the doubt. That's probably exactly what he's here for, is to, you know, totally clarify the situation, right? But of course, his previous statements don't bear any resemblance to this whatsoever. So, not really sure if he is going to do that.
That spider has gone up and down so many times. It's like our lives, you know. Our lives are like this itty bitsy spider going up and down a spider web. And that's it. You're not really doing anything. The spider hasn't done anything. Some fragile little tiny threads or something, but they don't amount to anything. And finally we realize, oh, I'm not really a spider. I was only pretending to be this itsy bitsy little spider. I'm really formless spirit, perfectly free, perfectly creative, sovereign over all experiencing, you know, untouchable by all experiencing, never unchangeable, perfect standing with the Creator. That's what I really am. Impossible to sin against God. Impossible, therefore, to have any guilt. Perfectly at peace, perfectly at calm, perfectly unthreatened. Yeah, not that itsy bitsy little spider at all. So, you know, I'm in good humor, good mood, good humor, right? You gotta stay in good humor, good mood these days. It's very important, that's the most important. Don't lose your perspective. You know, keep your sense of humor. You know, and let everybody off the hook in that way. Just say, look, we know you're just pulling our leg. That's okay. We get the joke. You know, we're not angry at you. We're having a good chuckle about it. You know, and making light of it in the right way. And so there's not this rift or anything. I mean, because everyone has perfect standing. We all have perfect standing. We're just doing a doggone good creative job of pretending otherwise, aren't we? And what can we do except sort of honor our creativity? It is the thing. This is the mood. This is the mood I have. I mean, I honor the creativity of everybody who's doing everything. The Pope, the President, whatever. I honor the creativity involved in all this. Absolutely. And chuckle at it, you know. And then at the same time, we understand that they're marketing something that we don't want. And so we ask to be, you know,
take refuge from that. We don't want them to pull the wool over our eyes, do we? No, we don't. But we don't have a hateful attitude either. We don't have a fear-based attitude either, right? And you know, the instant they repent, we call them to repentance. The instant they repent, hey, welcome to the fold. You know, absolutely. I'm giving them the same advice I give everybody. I give advice to everybody, the same advice, the same truth. It's not something greater for one, lesser the other. It's the same. And I'm not saying, oh, you're a bad person, you can't have this advice. No, giving advice to everyone. So that right there should, you know, shows the right spirit to have. Because everybody has to ultimately set pretense down. There's no way around it. And we're all in perfect standing with God and with one another. Perfect standing. There's no way around that either. So we gotta keep it lighthearted here. And don't get mean-spirited and don't go into anger. You're basically there saying, who are you trying to fool? Come on, who are you trying to fool, really? Who are you really trying to fool? You know, it's like a kid trying to fool their parents or their older brother or sister. He's like, oh, come on, come on, come on. Yeah, I know that one. I know that one. It's kind of like we're saying, yeah, I know that one. Who are you trying to kid? We didn't just come down with yesterday's rain. Been around the block a few times here. Come on. And so there goes, they're trying to pull a fast one on us, but we're saying, that's just an old trick. You know, we know that trick. It's like, yeah, like a little brother or sister, you know, being mischievous. They say, come on. Gotta set you straight. You know, that's not gonna work. Crickets are cranking away. That's great. Do I have any water? I don't know. Maybe not. Out of water. Starting to cool down a little bit, so maybe it's possible it's a little cooler tomorrow. I don't know why there's no change in, you know, you never know here. The fog rolls in. All it takes is the offshore flow to stop, which the high pressure system moves. It's not then pushing the air, you know, offshore. Then automatically the cool air is sucked in and becomes onshore flow. It doesn't take a weather system to do that. It just means just when the high pressure system is no longer camped out and causing the air to circulate counterclockwise, I guess it would usually be. But anyway, it pushes. Well, it's not really a system, but it pushes the air away from it. The heavy pressure, you know, pushes the air. And it'll push it out towards the ocean here. Push it out. And then that pushes the fog layer, marine layer, we call it, way out to sea, dissipates it, and that's when we heat up. And when that high pressure is no longer pushing air out that direction, poof, the hot air rising then pulls in the cooler air and just sucks right in like a vacuum cleaner, and cools way down here. Air conditioning, automatic air conditioning here we have. That's why people like living here, is we have this air conditioning system for free. A lot of most people don't have air conditioners here. Most people don't. Because this the hot days are far and few between, and the marine layer always comes in very quickly. Well, they can put up with a few days, hot days, and it's not a big deal. And don't have the expense of air conditioning. Someone told me today that they were like studying the water expert in something, and they said if we don't get a bunch of rain, the turbines, the water won't be able to turn the turbines to generate electricity. We'll run out of electricity. Well, I mean, if Lake Mead drops too low, that could happen for a lot of Phoenix, Vegas, Los Angeles, and a lot of, I don't know about the other turbines where they are, but he seemed to know about it. But of course, we can't have coal plants anymore. They're shutting them all down. Can't have nuclear power. They're shutting those down or restricting them. So we get electricity. How? I mean, the grid gets a how again? I'm not sure. Maybe through running generators or wind power or... we get some from wind power. Of course, they're trying to shut those down too because it hurts the birds. So we're supposed to get it exactly how? Solar power? That's going to run everything? Our electricity? It's expensive, solar power. And, to be great if we had these capacitors or some type of batteries that would charge and hold, massive amount of energy, and like an energy sink that would just hold it. I mean, big companies have those, but they're huge. But if they get a small one, each house could have one, and then solar would just be charging all the time, and you might be able to run a lot of stuff off of that, actually, if they ever come up with that that type of battery, whatever you call it. I mean, the last 4 years in California, if we would have had solar everywhere, we'd probably had stored enough energy for the whole world. I mean, it's been sunny every day. I hardly had any cloudy days at all, blocking the sun. Of course, a lot of places in the world, you go deserts and stuff, it's like virtually 365 days of the year. So just chit-chatting away here, from time to time, going in and taking care of business and then relaxing a little bit. See, it's attitude right now. See, it's just an attitude. It's all about attitude right now during this week and going forward. Now, another interesting side is that I thought autumn started either yesterday, 20th or the 21st, because I was told that the first day of autumn, as soon as autumn starts, this autumn is when all the trouble is going to start. Severe. I mean, this marketing campaign, now we know what it is. And whatever false flags and various problems that are associated with it. Well, I just looked at the calendar and I said, oh my gosh, you never guess what day autumn actually starts. I never would have guessed it. My calendar says it starts the 23rd. Yeah, right, there's a September 23rd again, the first day of autumn. And what I've been told by Holy Spirit is this autumn, when it starts, this is when the troubles will start. Well, it starts on the 23rd. I always thought it was the 21st or the 22nd. I've never heard of the equinox is on the 21st, but for some reason they say it's the 23rd, which is, again, the Day of Atonement. So everything is just landing smack dab on the 23rd. And the guy who started the asteroid scare, was it Efren Rodriguez or something? Something like that. He has a Facebook page and blog, whatever. He says, we didn't say the 23rd. We never gave a date. No, so I don't know where it came, the 23rd came from, but for that thing too. This asteroid is supposed to hit on the 23rd also. I'm not sure where that came from. Maybe someone just said, well, it's such a doomed date that if asteroids are coming, that might as well throw them in the mix too, Potpourri, what do you call it? Bouillabaisse soup or something. Just throw everything in there. Even your old leather shoes, just throw them in. That's the soup that just like all your leftovers, all your peelings from the turnips, the parsley, the radishes, the rutabagas, the parsley and the thyme and chicken scraps. I mean, just everything you've got in the kitchen. They did fresh food all the time. And things got very scrappy. The potato peelings, carrot peelings. You name it, they just all throw it in the soup pot. Just have the soup pot simmering there on the stove, and they just keep tossing the peelings in from all the vegetables and meats and everything they did, and that would ultimately be the bouillabaisse soup. Very tasty soup, some would say. trimmings from the cabbage and the spinach and the, I don't know if they put fruit peelings in there. Maybe, why not? Apple skins, all the skins. I don't know if people still do that. Probably in Europe they still do. I've heard people tell me in Europe the farmers markets and everything is just out of this world. You can't believe it. It's like another world. It's just astonishing. You know, 400 types of cheese, you know, and there's like just massive different types of every last thing possible, all fresh. You know, just they come that day and everyone goes to the market every day. It's just, they market still every day, you know, fresh food, let me get it right fresh. It was just made today, it's just picked today. And they go over and get the best of it, go home, they cook it that day. And us Americans are, you know, going to Mickey D's and saying, give me a mini meal. Give me a $2.50 mini meal. Wow, those are good fries. You know? Or you can go to In-N-Out Burger and get fresh fries. Get fresh, they make them right in front of you. Get the taters right there. And they're pretty good. Just letting the wow sink in, because we've gone over some very, very, very intense stuff here. Very helpful stuff, intense stuff. I mean, this is it. This week is it, right? So we're just having fun here. This week is it. This is the most important week in the history of this planet. For sure. And in hindsight, we'll look back and say, wow. You know, everything tipped on this during this week. And we've been warned. There's so much synchronicity pointing to this week. Massive. We thought 2012... 1221 was, well, that was just some date that supposedly, you know, the Mayan calendar pointed out, but there wasn't really that much synchronicity pointing to it, really. It was just, we thought, well, the Mayans must have known something, and that's when their calendar turns over, and that's, so that's the turnover times, and, you know, everybody thought, well, that maybe this is it. But this date, it has massive synchronicities and numbers, and, pre-programming in all sorts of media. You know, it's just astonishing. It's a super jubilee, you know. Also, I mean, start of the super jubilee, on and on and on and on and on and on. The 50th, you know, Jewish tradition. It just doesn't stop. It just does not stop. And it just so happens that this, you know, the pontiff is showing up in Washington, D.C. Now, some say it's to have a safe bunker. You know, there's probably an underground bunker, I'm sure, in Washington, D.C. to protect all the bigwigs in case there's some sort of, you know, disaster of some sort of it, whatever it might be. I don't know what it could be, but maybe some say the Pope is here to be safe and then to emerge after some catastrophe to reassure everybody, you know, as possible. Very symbolic. Hopefully that's not it. Hopefully that's not it. But I still keep getting intense symbology pointed out to me about two definite impacts of some sort. So, I don't know. I hope it's all much ado about nothing. Because we're having too much of a good time here. That is for sure. We love pursuing this option of setting down our pretense. We absolutely love it. It's a fantastic path. I mean, we get to talk about these great teachers. Isn't that cool? It's just awesome. Get to be informed about these great teachers. I mean, I can say all sorts of stuff about it. I mean, it's great talking about these teachers. What better to talk about? What are we supposed to talk about? The Kardashians or something? Or talk about, you know, Nandamaima or Ramana Maharshi or something? Come on. I mean, what's more interesting to talk about? We get to talk about this. The others got to settle for these celebrities. The celebrity, look how beautiful the celebrity. Beautiful? Looks like someone out of a grade B horror movie. Looks like something you might encounter in a graveyard. Or some zombie movie. Beautiful? Are you kidding me? You take a second look, say, wait a minute, this looks pretty frightening. It's something I'd probably beat Usain Bolt in the 100 running away from it, you know? It's like, wow. This is beauty, I'm coming beauty, embrace this beauty. Said, no. Get away, no. Hey, you know, if you're pursued by someone like that, You'd get God in a hurry. You find out you probably pray the best prayer in your life. So we're the fortunate ones. Very, very fortunate. I certainly know this. I'm aware of this. Very fortunate. You just got to wear it. You got to accept it. You know, they will be fortunate sometime also, eventually, too. Their time will come when they finally repent. In the meantime, you know, we show them the way. Say, you know, it's worth it. It's having great good fortune is wonderful. Who knows what tomorrow will bring, Tuesday. And then that next day is the 23rd, son of a gun. This whole week, all the way through the 28th, you know, I mean, it's just a week plus. The week plus is really, I mean, the intensity is just going to be ratcheted up and ratcheted up and ratcheted up. Kicking off the big campaign, global campaign here. We're talking about global stuff here. These folks think globally. So they're kicking off the big global campaign here. Give the bishops the word. Give the American bishops the word. You know, American bishops are hard to keep in line. They got their own ideas. And so the pontiff is here to set them straight. Say, hey, you know, you got to toe the line here. I'm telling you what's what. We'll see how that works out. They'll make little mention of it, probably. You know, some bishops say, well, you know, we kick up a second collection here for this issue here, and then they just drop it. That's it. It's in the bulletin, taking a second collection, and then they just don't mention it again. This is how they function. Yeah, these. What if they don't? If the bishop doesn't like the issue, and the pope's telling, they'll put in a bulletin. They'll make a little announcement, and then, you know, on with the song, and the mass keeps going. And that's it. They don't make a big deal of it. They don't push it. They do the minimum necessary. Just say they're not being, you know, heretical or something. Not trying to be excommunicated themselves. But you don't idly push bishops around. That's for sure. Our bishop is a very large person, actually. Gigantic. I mean, he's just like, you just feel the weightiness of it, you know. With all the robes and everything, it's like bigger than life. He doesn't seem like a person that you, you know, would dictate to. You got this, what you got to do. I think he's a good bishop, actually. I really do. And of course, the bishop tells the priest, you know, this is the what we want you to emphasize. And so that priest go out to all the different churches, and then they tell they emphasize what, you know, pretty much what the bishop wants them to, unless there's some kind of radical priest who trying to do their own thing, which in case then they ultimately get in trouble with the bishop. Generally speaking, but they have some latitude for sure. Yeah. But if you're a priest and you know you go tell the congregation, hey, abortion is great. You know, the Catholic Church absolutely supports abortion. This is what we should be supporting. You know, well, they're gonna get a call from the bishop for sure, and say, well, we don't support it, abortion, and we don't want you telling the congregation that we do. And we'd like to ask you not to do that again. They do it very nicely. Very nicely, you know. And they get the point home. And if they do it again, they might find themselves, we need you to build a high school for us, you know. And you need to devote your time to that. It's, you know, you're being promoted. We're going to promote you. You know, you think that you're better suited for that. So maybe, you know, the Pope is here to say, hey, bishops, I'm going right past you, just like the president loves to go right past Congress. Now, the Pope is maybe just bypassing all the bishops and going straight to the elected officials, the secular power in the United States, and getting the secular power to support him, which they certainly will. A lot of them will. I think he'll gain a majority support for sure for his agenda. And in that way, he's just bypassing the bishops. I mean, this is really what it sounds like. I mean, he's not exactly addressing the conference of bishops here in the United States. I mean, he's talking to some of them, but this may be his plan. Isn't that interesting? His Jesuit plan of just bypass the bishops. If they won't go for your agenda, then just push it politically. Push it politically here. Wow. That's quite a thought, isn't it? Holy cow. And then go to the United Nations, too, and just bypass the bishops of the world. Because the bishops are the ones standing in the way of the Pope's agenda. There's no question about it. And yeah, I'm sure he knows this. Of course he knows it. So he's just bypassing them. He's going to the United Nations and the United States Joint Session of Congress and the United States President, as well as other religious leaders around the world, heads of those religious leaders, saying, hey, you know, we know what's best for the world. Why should we have to, have trouble with the bishops here? Let's just bypass them. Just like the president just signs an executive order. If Congress won't give him what he wants, he just says, well, I'll just sign an executive order. Doesn't matter. You don't want this treaty with something? I'll just call it an accord, and I'll just decree that it's a done deal, and that's it. Just bypass the Congress. So maybe the Pope's just bypassing the bishops here. Maybe that's his end game here. Maybe that's his plan. Wow. I might have hit the nail on the head here, actually. Because, you know, bishops, I mean, I have a lot of respect for bishops. At least the one we have here, I said, well, you know, they try to do a good job, a lot of them, not all of them, you know, there have been some problems for sure, but I would say by and large, you know, they really want to do Christ's work here in the world as best as they understand it, and gotta respect that, you know, I mean, gotta respect that they try their best, even if it may come up short, so that they're... they may not give the Pope what he wants, you know, which is to fundamentally change the mission of the church. So, Pope's just going to, you know, go around him, bypass him, become a political figure, politicize the whole thing, politicize the entire situation. I think that's what's going on. This is what's been going on with the church for a long time. They've been trying to politicize it. This is what the president's been trying to do. The secular humanists have been trying to politicize the entire situation so then they can put pressure on the church that they have to go along. And they'll just leave the bishops out in the cold, say, sorry, bishops, you know, you don't have any authority anymore because we politicized the entire thing. And then they'll pass laws and stuff that ultimately force the bishops out. I think they think the prophecy, Malachi prophecy, this is the last pope. He said number 112, but because he was starting from when the prophecy happened. But this is the last pope, Peter the Roman, and coming from Saint Francis Pietro de something, which is really Saint Francis Peter of Rome, Peter the Roman. That's why the Malachi prophecy is accurate here. This is the last pope, and this last pope is going to bring about the destruction of the church. This is the prophecy. And so this pope is certainly going in that direction, trying to marginalize the bishops, politicize the whole situation, put himself up as way above the bishops, you know, as having some sort of global political mandate and authority too. And then if the bishops don't go along, you say, well, you know, you're out of the mainstream thought and you're just an anomaly right now, an outlier, and don't have any more authority. And at some point he may start removing bishops if he has the political clout to do so. You know, so we're headed down a very, 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 very stormy, dark road here. And of course the president might say, hey, just bypass all any political opposition, say, hey, I got the Pope agreeing with me. I got moral authority I don't need to depend on Congress anymore. They're just obstructionist. So I'll just make any decree I want. I got global moral authority here. And politicize it and give some sort of religious power to the whole thing too. And so they're kind of double teaming us right here, the Pope and the president. They're double teaming us. Right? Pope will say, I got political authority. The president will say, I have religious moral authority. And that gives me the right to just bypass any opposition to what we want. Yeah, see, I say the most important week in history. This is very true. Very true what's going on here. I'll take any one of those four great spiritual teachers, you know, to have my back, you know. I'll put any one of them up there to protect my back, that is for sure. Now, as anonymous, I would certainly be the one who's most amusing. Her tactics would be certainly the most amusing for sure. It might get more, you know, laughs out of us and keep us in good humor. Trying to deal with her is just absolutely... they don't even know what they'd be in for, that is for sure. I think Jesus, Longchamp, and Raharshi would be more, you know, cut and dried, you know, which is wonderful too. Would love to see that. But Anandamayi Ma could play any role whatsoever, you know. The little child, you know, the little daughter, everything. And just nobody could do anything about it, you know. It was she had infinite ways of getting her what she wanted and getting her point across, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, just infinite ways.
whatever the situation called for. That would be keep us in good humor, that is for sure. She would cry, you know, she would just cry a river of tears, you know, just sobbing, inconsolably sobbing tears, you know. And finally say, just stop crying, please stop crying, please, you're just driving me crazy, I can't stand it anymore. Just, you know, just okay, you know. I'll straighten my ways out. Just please stop crying. It's just too much. It's just too much. But you used them in the right way, you know. She used them the right way. She had all the tactics, all the tactics that men use, all the tactics that women use. She could use any tactic and many more that nobody has ever even thought of. But they used them in the right way. It was pretty funny, very funny. Could pretend to be stupid, very good at pretending to be stupid. Could pretend to be a little crazy. Could pretend to just be a little nobody. Little Miss Muppet sitting on a tuffet, you know. Or I could pretend to be Kali, you know, the ferocious goddess, or the Shiva, the dancer, whatever. You know, could pretend. It's just. It's all pretense. You know, it was all pretense. Never identified with any of it. But had the complete palette of all pretense available. But it was all presented in a divine way, so nobody took offense. In fact, they were like. It caused them to, like, have a holy instant, like, wow, this is something absolutely profound. But the whole palette of pretense was there. Completely naive. Totally naive. And there's nothing anyone can do because they couldn't break her pretense. You know, it was like flawless. Flawless pretense. But of course, never identifying with the pretense, completely aware that it's just pretense. This is, you know, extraordinary. We can't do that. Not yet at all. We're not there yet. That is for sure. But we can appreciate it, and, you know, it's very helpful. One moment, you know, the great guru who knows all answers to everything. The next moment, just a little complete waif, naive waif who doesn't have any idea about any gurus or teachers or anything. You know, the mute imbecile. I'm nobody's guru. I'm nobody. You know, I don't know anything about anything. No, I'm just a little child here. I have mental problems, a little child here. I'm just completely don't know anything. It's quite amusing, very entertaining for everyone. You know, those who are involved with that, you know, it's very, very, very spiritually entertaining. It's like, what in the world's going to happen next? They never knew what was going to happen next. They never knew. And a new surprise around every corner. And of course, time was completely flexible too. So she'd suddenly say, "Ah, a snake has bitten me!" Or people said, "What are you talking about? What are you talking about?" And then a couple days later, a cobra would bite her or something, and they said, "Was that the snake?" "Oh yeah, yeah, I saw the snake was going to come and bite me, and I invited it to come and bite me." "So, why'd you do that?" "Well, you know, I don't know. I just had the idea that it was a good idea." And then later they'd find out that it was actually a karma of one of her devotees that they'd be bitten and die from a snake bite. And she just had the idea that it'd be a good idea if the snake bit her instead. And of course they said, whoa, you're going to die. She goes, no, everything's fine, don't worry. It'll be fine. And then they'd check, and oh, you know, there's nothing.
It all healed up like that, you know, no symptoms at all. She could play dumb, but I don't know why I'm doing this. It's just, you know, it's just my chaos. It's just a play of God, you know, and I'm just, you know, just whatever happens, happens.
You know, play the ditzy, you know, this sort of ditzy, like I did. Yeah, I know, maybe this, and maybe this is this, and not sure why this is happening, but it's just very ditzy. You could do that, you know, the ultra serious, the completely silent,
totally disciplined, suddenly just a super philosopher, you know, great, like a great Vedic Rishi. You can instantly go into Vedic Rishi mode. Everyone just like, oh my God, this is like, just I'm in the presence of some ancient Rishi here. Should go to any guru mode whatsoever has ever been, just instantly just go completely, and then people will say, I'm in the presence of this great guru, go into Shankara mode, just like that. Go through them real fast too. You know? And then, not identify with all, then back into a little girl mode or whatever next mode, just like, you know, sweet little girl mode, just, and I don't know anything, I'm just a little child, little waif.
And next moment, you know,
next moment be uttering Sanskrit hymns or something, you know, just like exalted Sanskrit hymns, and next moment something else is just like continually flowed that way, continuously like that. You never knew what was next. And people say, well, what are you? You know, just, well, I'm whatever you take me to be.
You take me to be a great Rishi.
Here's the great Rishi. Devotees, they'd have desires to see her a certain way, and suddenly she'd be that way. And they say, oh my gosh, she fulfilled my desire. I wanted to be in the presence of some ancient great Rishi, and there the great Rishi was, suddenly. And then once that desire had been fulfilled, they say, oh, you know, then it changed. So she said, you know, I'm whatever you take me to be, as long as it's for your spiritual benefit. So, right? Always positive sort of thing.
I want to have an illness.
And I want that illness too. I want that illness too. You got cancer? Really? I want cancer. Oh yeah, that must be fun. How come I can have cancer? I want cancer. You know, then you get cancer. Oh great, she'd say. I finally had cancer. I got what you have too. Isn't that great? Love it. And you know, and of course what you're doing ultimately, you know, is like somehow freeing someone from cancer. And maybe many people from it, you know, it's hard to say, but. And then when she said, okay, I've had enough fun with the cancer, and then, boom, instantly the cancer just vanished, gone. Because it's all pretense, 100%. Preaching to everything here is pretense. Yeah, it's helpful if you understand, you know, what it's about, the play. If you understand the divine play, it's very helpful. Why can't we have gurus like that? Why can't we have teachers like that? We obviously deserve it. We obviously should have teachers like that. Put on that kind of play. It's called a divine leela, divine play. Absolutely. To show us it's just all pretense. It's all pretend. That's all it is. Because we have to realize that too. Getting pretty closer to the end of this video. Absolutely we are. Although it seems that we're going to maybe get some extra time here. I mean, wait a minute. Is this possible? This is really amazing, folks. That's some kind of miracle. It's going to shut off anyway. It's bound to. But it shows I've only used 2.67 gigabytes. I have 4. It shuts off once I reach close to 4 gigabytes, no matter what. And it's 2 hours and 30 minutes. It's already 2:30 here, basically. We'll be in 30 seconds. and I've only used 2.68 gigabytes. This is extraordinary. This is extraordinary. And you know what it must be is I just had this Holy Spirit inspiration. And my mom would call it K Hall, but the Holy Spirit inspiration to adjust the video with this washed out look like this. I've never had this look yet before. I didn't know I could get this look, and I was like, "What? This is a kind of pretty cool look. I want to do this look." I think it's this washed out look where there's like just this white and blue tone that somehow it uses much less a memory to code the video. So it's only 2.69 gigabytes. That's astonishing. We have like almost 1.5 gigabytes left. I mean, it's like we have like an hour left or more here. I could do an hour more of this stand-up spiritual comedy show here, whatever you want to call it. This is not even a name for it, is there? Maybe more stories of Ananda, my mom, maybe. I got endless stories, really. I can keep pulling them out of a hat, probably. Oh, but we're going to run out of space. We only have 1.94 gigabytes left. No, we're not going to run out of space. Almost run out of space if we keep going here. The way she would do it is, let's say the modern time, the whores of Babylon come to her and say, "We want you to be one of us. You got to be this whorish woman," and she'd play the little child. "I'm just a little tiny little girl. I'm sorry. I don't have any understanding of those kind of things and feelings and ways like that. And I'd love to help you out, but I can't help you out because I'm just this little tiny little child. I'm not able to be that way for you. I'd like to, you know, but I can't." Do something like that. Or she might go into wrathful collie mode. So, "Okay, you want me to be a real bad woman? Here's, I'll be a real bad woman. How's this? Scare the heck out of them." And they say, I think that's a little too badass for us. I think we'll get the heck out of here." I don't know. Either one or something else. But yeah, you wouldn't like reject people. So yeah, sure, I'd love to do what you asked me to do. But if it was something that was inimical to the spiritual path, you'd say, "But you know, I'm really sorry that I'm not able to always do what you want because I seem to have something wrong with me. There's something wrong with me. I got some malfunction and maybe in some way, and I'm not able to accommodate everybody's request. You know, I'm something a little cuckoo maybe with me." So she'd make an excuse like that. Yeah, I think people say I was born a little cuckoo, and so you know, sometimes I'm not able to fulfill everyone's requests, you know, but I'm very sorry. And then she'd start crying, you know, like, "I'm so sorry, I'm crying and they'd say, "No, don't cry, come on, we're, you know, it's okay, you don't have to be a a wicked woman, you know, and we're sorry we even asked you, you know. It's just like, wow. And they'd end up kind of like repenting. She'd find some way to get them start towards repentance, you know. Even the most wicked woman in the world, she'd find some way to turn them toward repentance like that. Just cry. She'd be dead, you know. It's completely, inconsolably upset with herself that she wouldn't be able to go with them and hang with them, you know, the wicked whores of Babylon. Inconsolable, crying and sobbing and saying, I'm so sorry that, you know, I'm unable to do this for you. I can't take it anymore. I'm so sad. And then they'd break them, you know, she'd break them. Break the hardest heart in the world. They say, please, please, please stop. You're just killing me here. I can't take it. You know, this is too much. I'm sorry. I don't know what got into me. I don't really want to be this wicked, you know. I don't really want you to be that way. I don't even want to be that way, you know. But I don't know what got into me. Some kind of devil's got into me that I've been acting this way. It's really terrible, you know. I mean, what can I do to get you to stop crying, you know? She says, I don't know. Can you at least think of me like once a day for like just 5 minutes a day? I mean, if you do that, maybe I'll stop crying, you know. And they'd say, okay, sure, I can do that. And then they'd actually start doing that. So you could take the wickedest woman in the world and she could, you know, flip them around and get them to repent, actually.
Although, I'm not sure she managed with every single one of them. Maybe Indira Gandhi didn't quite go for it, even though she said she was her devotee. Maybe she was,
I don't know. Or maybe she was just trying to politicize the situation, which she was very adept at for sure. Out of the dynasty, pretty much got it in some ways. But you see pictures of Indira Gandhi with mine, you know, at her feet and everything. But, I mean, did she really repent? Who knows? I hope so. But she was a pretty tough cookie. Met an unfortunate end. Maybe she's thinking, wow, maybe I should have repented. Maybe it wasn't her time, you know, So she, you know, my mom was often just very quiet when Indira Gandhi was there. She'd just ignore her, kind of. Maybe it wasn't her time to repent. But there had to be a political show there, you know. Indira Gandhi needed to show India that she respected the spiritual traditions of India, you know, and so to come to Nanamayama and to prostrate before, you know, it showed all India, I'm really very spiritual person too, and very much respect traditions. I'm not really some power hungry, you know, empress or something. And so, you know, it may have been for show. It's possible. The daughter of Indira Gandhi the mother, sorry, Nehru and Kamala Nehru. Kamala was a very devout devotee of Anandamayi, a genuine one. But Indira Gandhi used to see her when she was a child a lot and stuff, but she may have not been such a big devotee, actually. You know, we're just speculating here, but, you know, reading the tea leaves. And politics is a nasty brew, you know, that nasty addiction. Boy. Thank God, you know, sidestepped that one, at least this lifetime. I think at some previous life I may have had been, you know, involved in some position of political influence and stuff, but, you know, boy, sidestepped, I guess, stay away from that one. Sometimes the lower the status, the better in this world. So you can avoid temptation
and say, "Ah, gee, sorry, I can't do that. I've been permanently tainted. I'm a sudra, you know. I'm an untouchable. I've been picking up garbage. You know, I'm disqualified myself. You know, gee, I'd really like to, but I'm tainted and contaminated. I can't do it. You know, can't. It's not possible. I've been disqualified." Very helpful. Very, very helpful. Takes the temptation away. You can just say, well, yeah, I mean, just wouldn't be right, you know, to have somebody who's been in such a lowly position like this. It just wouldn't, can't put that over on high society, you know. They just wouldn't have it. It just wouldn't work. So I'll have to maybe defer to some other life, maybe next life. Who knows? Oh, this is the last one? Oh, shucks. Shucks. Oh, well. That's the way the cookie crumbles. So, yeah, I mean, we're still cooking along here. We're cooking with gas right now. I mean, this is extraordinary. How did the Holy Spirit arrange this? You know, I didn't have any expectation of this. We're getting like overtime here. I haven't eaten much today. I haven't drinking much today. I don't think there's any water, but oh, there's a little water here. Just a sip. Just a sip. That's enough for it. Great. So, hey, if we don't talk now, we may never talk again, you know. I mean, this is the week. If we can't stand up and speak our mind now, we're liable not to be able to do it going forward at all. If we can't maintain our humor, by the way, you know, humor is a sign of people who have, you know, really good standing, right? I mean, understand that they have true standing. If you're able to be, you know, humorous and, you know, court jester can, you know, joke everybody, all the aristocracy, court jester has some extraordinary standing. And, you know, the people realize that, hey, you know, the joker's way wiser than we, I mean, the jester's way wiser than we are. So we better mind our P's and Q's. Right? So if we can joke about all this, that means we have extraordinary standing, you know. This is an expression of it. When we're able to talk in an affable and in a jesterish way about these big, really big wigs and important stuff that's going on, and, you know, point out, you know, the folly of it all without being too severe or anything, that's very high standing. And if you can't do that, I guess you know, go to Vegas and be a comic there and try to, you know, hit as low as you possibly can. Yeah, it's like, wow, that's really sad. Those comics that are just trying to be as vicious as possible, as lowbrow as possible, and I feel, you know, it's just, wow. It's just, they're not happy people, to say the least. They're just expressing their feeling of powerlessness and anger and bitterness to the world. But, you know, we're not bitter or angry because we know we're on the path to freedom and can't be stopped.
See, there's the feeling we can't be stopped. We cannot be stopped. And this is where my confidence comes from, is, I cannot be stopped in terms of salvation. You know, the path, the momentum, all that, it's going to happen, it's going to happen, it's going to happen. Cannot be stopped. No, unstoppable. So that's a good feeling to have, you know, a very confident feeling. Whereas the comedians, commercial comedians, you know, they feel like they're in some dead end. They can't get out of it. They're trying to make light of it, but they say, wow, I don't even know what kind of jokes they tell, but they're not funny. They're not really humorous at all. And laughing at the folly of the other option, realizing how it's nothing at all. You know, it's folly, it's funny. And so to be able to look back in hindsight and have a good laugh at it is very, very good. It means, you know, that you're certain that you cannot be stopped to salvation. You cannot be stopped. Holy Spirit will see to that. Just hanging out with the gigabytes. I might get a call here pretty soon. Say, what are you doing out so late? I think it's coming. Yeah. I don't know. This is a gigabyte. I just got gigabytes tonight. It's a good night to have gigabytes. It's a good night to have extra gigabytes here. We're going overtime. You're such a good audience. We're going to keep playing all night here. Pull a George Jones and play all night. He'd get drunk, high as a kite, drunk, and then he'd just want to play all night. They'd have to drag him off the stage. Say, hey, George, it's been 4 hours, man. We got to shut down. He says, no. And then what he'd do, he'd go to a local bar, say, hey, folks, I'm going to play at the bar. And then he'd play at the bar till 4 in the morning. And then from there you go to somebody's house or whatever and play till 8 in the morning. Yeah. Then he'd get in a car and disappear.
He'd get someone to drive him somewhere, and he'd play all day long, as they'd singing and playing all day long as they drove somewhere, and then get on stage and somewhere in a bar somewhere and play and keep singing more. He just, you know, as long as he was flying high, he'd just keep playing and singing. Of course, paid a price later on for it. And you know, end up in some, you know, mental institution in Alabama somewhere or something like that, you know. you didn't want
to end up there. The white coats would look after you pretty carefully there. Men in the white coats. They say, you know, you ain't getting out of here until you straighten up. And they weren't joking.
You could get out of any place, except you couldn't get out of those Alabama mental institutions. The assistants there were experts in preventing escape, because a lot of the inmates were experts in escaping. Because they didn't really want to be there. Most of them didn't really want to be there, right? They said, I don't belong here. You know, I got to conduct a Napoleonic campaign. What am I doing here? It's ridiculous. My troops are awaiting me. I must go
and sound, give them the command to march.
So they would be experts in disappearing. And then there'd be a great hunt for them. Where'd they go? And they'd probably find him in the town square dressed up as Napoleon saying, you know,
troops ready. Okay. So the troops aren't quite ready for you yet, sir.
You know, the smart doctor, sir. The
troops are not quite ready for you yet. And I can see you've given them the command, and what a great general you are. And we'd like to invite you over some tea. Come over and have some tea, and we'll talk about the strategy of the upcoming campaign. Oh, okay. Yeah, great.
And then come back there, you know. So,
I mean, they had humane ways of dealing with situations.
Jones thought he was a Daffy Duck or something.
Yeah. Don't know why. He didn't really know either. The duck and the old man have arguments between a duck and an old man. Angry old man and a duck. They're getting in big arguments. I think the duck usually won. I'm not sure.
So, you know, but he didn't really know why. Why? It's just
nobody really did know why. Just one of them things, I guess. Maybe too much white lightning growing up. Possible.
Too many of those guys had their old pappies had a still, you know. And it's true.
A lot of moonshine back there. A lot of white lightning. Not so good for you.
Kind of make you blind, I guess.
We're back in North Carolina. We're back in the hills. Lived my old pa, and he had him a still. He brewed white lightning till the sun went down. Then he'd fill him a jug and he'd pass it around. Mighty, mighty pleasing. My pappy's corn squeezing. Whoa! White lightning.
Yeah.
But we're not on that. We're just on H2O. H2O. Water. Water and hunger. And a bunch of extra gigabytes. Keeping it light as we go through the most intense, heaviest week in history. Keeping it light here. Well, a city sicker came and said, I'm tough. I want to try some of your daddy's stuff, something like that. So he took one slug and he drank it on down. And I heard him moaning as he hit the ground. Mighty, mighty pleasing, your pappy's corn squeezing. Wow, white lightning. Well, the G-men, T-men, the revenuers too, searching for a place where my daddy made his brew. They were looking, trying to book him, but my daddy kept on cooking. Whew, white lightning. Maybe we'll sing all night here as the clock keeps ticking and the video keeps recording. Maybe that's significant. Is that a significant number? 312. I don't know. 312. What's that? 36. Or maybe 12 and 12 is 24th. Add 12 to that. It's 6th. Okay, very important. The mood is very important. The attitude now. The mood, the attitude, confidence, okay? What we're expressing here is confidence. We're making light of the whole situation. We're not saying it's not intense, not saying all this stuff's not going to happen, etc. But we're making light of it because we say, it doesn't matter, come with me. They cannot stop us. They're looking, trying to book them, but my pappy kept on cooking. So, you know, right? You got the G-men, the T-men, the Reveners, too, searching for a place where he made his brew. But they were looking, trying to bug him with the cocoon. My pappy kept on cooking. White lightning. So they're looking, trying to book us. They can't stop us. They're looking, trying to stop us, but they cannot. Cannot be stopped. One way or another. You know, we're going to get it. We're going to find it. One way or another. Yeah. I'm going to get you. I'm going to get it. Get it. One way. Maybe this week, I'm going to find it. One day, maybe this week, yeah. From one way or another, Blondie, one way or another, we're going to find it, we're going to get it, absolutely. Can't be stopped. Cannot be stopped. Been confirmed, been clarified, accepted, seen up the reason. So, we're not down. We understand the severity of the situation in the world, absolutely. So, we're focused, clear and focused, but we're not going to lose our sense of humor, we're not going to lose our confidence. This is very important. This is another thing a great teacher can do, is instill this confidence. Now, I don't know who the humorous ones are among the crowd. Not really sure. Maybe Jesus is the humorous one. I don't know. Lorana Maharshi, was he full of humor? Maybe, I don't know. Longchampa, I'm not sure. Or Jesus, I'm not sure. Nandamaya, maybe she's full of humor. Yeah, she was. But the humor that comes with certainty, absolute confidence, you know. Making light of everything. See the lighter side of pale, you know. Yeah. We dance the light fandango, as the miller told his tale. As something was turning cartwheels. I try to find those lyrics. We dance the light fandango. I was feeling kind of seasick. As the something called out for more, 16 vessel virgins, da 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 da, and so there was a light. So, yeah, a little bit harder to churn out those lyrics. The lighter side of pale, turn the light wider, shade of pale. Whiter shade of pale. Well, we're turning the lighter side of jail, you know. This is the lighter side of jail. Yeah, because everybody's saying, hey, you know, welcome to jail. It's so nice. You're going to love it. And we say, well, you know, I'm going to love it in my own way, which is I'm going to love it by leaving it. That's how I'm going to love it. And the jail's going to be happy and thank me for leaving it too.
jail's tired of me, actually. Wants to kick me out. Just get out of jail. Can't stand you in here anymore. The lighter side of jail. Give him the Vestal Virgins a headache. Yeah, get rid of this guy. You know. doesn't do what we tell him to do. Nah, they don't say that. They say, yeah, you know, it's all good. It's all good. He's making us laugh. You know, you gotta leave. Making us laugh or not. Can't keep the fire going. We're laughing too much. It's a distraction. So, you get to leave Rome. Ah, but Rome already left me first. What can I do? I tell you what, I'll both leave Rome and not leave Rome. How about that? I'll neither leave Rome nor will I not leave Rome. We'll call it good. Call it good. Good, it's good. It's all good. We're just gonna keep playing until Elvis shows up here, folks. We know he's somewhere. I think he's en route. Limousine's got stuck in traffic. I'm gonna listen to old James Burton on a guitar here. Do some picking, down home picking for you. And Elvis is gonna show up real soon. Meanwhile, you know, here's the Jordanaires. Singing, swing low, sweet chariot, coming to carry me home. Yeah, whatever happened to that good old gospel music, you know? Hey, even Elvis did a lot of gospel music. You know where he was from, right? Tupelo, Mississippi. You don't get too big for your britches. You don't get too big for the Lord down there, you see. Yeah. All those good old boys and girls, they'd have a gospel a section of their concert. You better believe it. It's the best part of the concert, right? The best music of all. You get old Mama Cook coming out there singing. You know, everybody got real. Everybody got real, you hear that? They said, hey, I was forgetting that I was a sinner, meaning I was forgetting I got a continuity problem here. I got a problem with the Lord. I mean, I'm not right with the Lord, right? We're not right with the Lord because we're trying to pretend that we're something different than how God created us, which is perfect spirit, perfect standing, absolute freedom. We're pretending that we're these mortal, you know, whatever, stick figures, I guess, you know. Furnaces. We're walking furnaces, you know. We keep feeding coal into our mouths and carbon. Might as well be coal. Carbon. And we burn up this carbon, you know. We're just walking furnaces, you know. It's like, right? Should have a smokestack somewhere. How about we breathe out CO2 or something? Yeah, we're just these furnaces, mobile furnaces. Except I didn't have too much coal today. Just some heavily seasoned Doritos. Or Tostitos. Maybe it was Tostitos. Pretty hard to turn down Tostitos. It's a diet breaker. How are we doing on this video here? 3.5 gigabytes. Okay, so yeah, we'll cruise in there about 3 hours and 20 minutes or something like that. Yeah, I'm going every night about this hour. If you be in town for a few more days, come on by the comedy club, where we do the lighter side of jail. How to get jail to love your leaving. By saying, well, I'm neither leaving you jail nor am I not leaving you. And the jail gets all sentimental about that. Starts sniffling and saying, oh my gosh, I'm really gonna miss him. But he's got it for him to go, but I'm gonna miss him. But I have the memories. So I keep the memories, yeah. I can. The cold concrete memories and the steel bars and the warden and everything. I keep the memories. But gotta go. Time to go. Even all the hound dogs are sad. Can't chase him no more. Gotta let him go. Yeah, parting is such sweet sorrow, even from jail, right? Yep, that's true, you know. But I say, don't worry, I'll come back and visit you. I'll even hang out and play you a song, sing you a song, too. And jail says, oh, that'd be great, you know. Thank you so much. But serious, I'm serious, you know. I'm leaving the old jail, but I'm gonna hang out on the picnic table outside, you know, and not gonna go far away. I'll sing some songs for the jail. Absolutely, I will. I'll sing all night for the jail. Don't get me started. Bad energy, I'll sing 24 hours a day. I can get to remember the lyrics. Jukebox is a little rusty. Rock the jukebox. Don't rock the jukebox, gotta hear some Jones. My heart ain't ready for the Rolling Stones. Ain't been the same since my baby went away or something. Ain't been the same. Yeah, I met a guy from Bakersfield. He said, hey, Crystal Palace, Buck Owens, are you kidding me? Buckaroos. Don Rich and the Buckaroos. Well, the sun's gonna shine in my life once more. Love's gonna live again. Things are gonna be the way they were before. Love's gonna live again. Love's gonna live here. Love's gonna live here. Love's gonna live here again. No more. No more unhappiness, no more sadness, only happiness. Love's gonna live here again. Yeah, there you go. The lyrics are starting to come back a little. Oh, the sun's gonna shine in my life once more. Love's gonna live here again. No more loneliness, only happiness. Love's gonna live here again. Take it, Don. You're picking the Telecaster there. Just in their Dobie Hacienda. What a shtick they had. Buck Owens and the Buckaroos. I mean, awesome. Yeah, I brought to mind that song, The Man from Bakersfield. I actually drove past the Crystal Palace one time, didn't go inside, it was late, had to get on down the road, but yeah, there it was. That's where he played all the time.
Even had old Merle Haggard show up occasionally. Sometimes they'd even drag in old George Jones, but not too often. But man, those boys had a time there, that is for sure. Honky tonkin'. I ain't gonna go honky tonkin' no more. Music from the honky tonks, the lonely songs they sing. Sad and lonely songs they sing. The music from the honky tonks, the lonely songs they play, lonely songs they sing, are coming through my window. Cause I live not far away, they're calling me to come back to the way things I used to do, but the lonely song. But the lonely songs and the honky tonks I left behind when I left you, the bright lights and the long nights of the bright lights and the night lights was your. Hanging out here, trying to go honky tonking. But the bright lights and the city lights was your style of being gay. But I couldn't see. But I couldn't go on that way. I hope someday you'll think again and try to. And try to understand and come away from the honky-tonks and back into my arms again. Yeah, back into my arms again. Great song. Missing a few, little fragment of lyric there. But as soon as I get it, like, boom, all songs would come back like that. Saying that, I've just done that song hundreds of times. I just can't remember, which is fine. Missing one word. Just hanging out here in this incredible evening. You know, it's so nice. The crickets are chirping. It's so warm. And we're just cruising here. Cruising in a Chrysler Imperial. 61 Chrysler Imperial. With windows down for air conditioning. On that wide open road. Johnny Cash. Wide open road. Going to who knows where, right? From one honky-tonk to another. Every little town's got one. Something like the bright nights, the bright lights and the city nights. That was your style of being gay. Didn't mean it in the modern sense. But if that's what it takes to keep your love, I just couldn't go on that way. It's a little bit off. I hope someday you'll think of me and try to understand and try to understand and come away from the honky tonks back into my arms again. So, oh, won't you come away from the honky tonks and come back into my arms again? So that this is a spiritual song, really. It's saying, you know, come away from the honky tonk, which is the world. The honky tonks is the option. Tried so hard to win your love, but I just couldn't go on that way. Yeah, something like that. Is the honky tonk is the world and the option of trying to make pretense permanent. It's like a honky tonk, you know. It's just like, wow. After a while, you say, hey, yeah, I just can't go on that way. So, I hope someday you'll think of me and try to understand and come away from the honky tonks back into my arms again. Maybe I should look that one up. No, it's good. It's close enough. Back into my arms again. Tempting me to come back to the way things I used to do. But the lonely songs, honky tonks and the lonely songs I left behind when I left you. The night lights and the party nights was your style of being gay. Although I want your love, I couldn't go on that way. Although I knew I'd miss your love, I just couldn't go on that way. Something like that. Bright lights and the city nights was your style of being gay. Although I knew I'd miss your love, I just couldn't go on that way. I hope someday you'll think again and try to understand and come away from the honky tonks back into my arms again. Awesome song. Awesome song. Very tough to sing. Jones sings it so well. It's just like incredible. One of the hidden gems, that song. Blistering song. You know, you talk about music, you talk about song, that's a song right there. Back Into My Arms by George Jones. Just hits you in the gut. Because it's real. It's saying, hey, you know, the lifestyle of drinking and honky-tonking and humanizing and partying, all this stuff. You know, I love you, but I just can't go on that way. And so I hope someday you'll think of me and try to understand and come away from the honky-tonks back into my arms again. I hope you repent. I hope someday you repent and walk the walk of repentance into the true glory of what we really are, and come back into the arms of truth and reason and true standing in God. You know, this is what it's getting at, really. It's just using romance as a foil for a deeper spiritual message, which a lot of country music does, actually. They hid the spiritual message. You make it a little popish by using, you know, romance and as a foil, as a front for deep spiritual truths. And if you have ears to hear it, it's there. Nobody could sing it like George Jones, I'm telling you. Blows your mind when you realize this is a spiritual song. Music of the honky tonk, the sad and lonely songs they play are coming through my window because I live not far away. They're calling me to come back to the things I used to do, but the lonely songs and honky tonks I left behind when I left you. The night lights and the party nights was your style of being gay. Although I knew I'd miss your love, I just couldn't go on that way. I hope someday you'll think of me and try to understand and come away from the honky tonks back into my arms again. talking about the world, talking about spirit, talking about the world, talking about spirit, talking about the world, talking about spirit. Those sad and lonely songs they play, the honky tonk is the world. Music from the honky tonk, sad and lonely songs they play, is the world coming through my window because I live not far away. Meaning, even though I'm in the world, trying to stay away from it, I can still hear it through my window. They're tempting me to come back to the things I used to do, right? That's the world tempting us to fall back into our bad habits. But the honky-tonks and the lonely songs I left behind when I left you, meaning continuity fears is, you know, telling us what a great companion it is. Come honky-tonking with me. You know, we'll have a ball. It's just a blast. Finally he said, no, that's enough, and I hope you change your ways. I hope you think of me and change your ways. And get back to what you really are. Stop, drop the pretending. Now, that's a real song. The stuff today, I don't know what they're doing today. It's, hey, let's join the bad girls in Babylon. Yeah. It's repulsive, you know, absolute opposite. They're saying, hey, let's everybody go honky-tonking. You know, that's a thing to do. And, I mean, we'll absolutely show you a good time. You know, just let's all go honky-tonking. I mean, who can turn that down? You know, nobody can turn that down, they say. Even the Pope and the President are turning it down. Come on, let's go honky-tonking. If you got the money, I got the time. If you got the money, I got the time. Yeah, it's an old Hank Williams song. We'll go honky-tonking. We'll have a great time. I'll get my own Cadillac. You get the Cadillac and I'll drive. Something like that. If you have the money, I've got the time. But if you ain't got no money, honey, I ain't got no time. If you've got the money, I've got the time. Hank Williams. This is the world, right? Let's go honky-tonking. If you got the money, I got the time. But we don't want that. Say no to that. Don't, ain't got no money. I ain't got no money, and I ain't got no time. Neither one. Forgot all the words of that one, but come back in a flash. Hey, jambalaya, crawfish pie, and a filet gumbo. Tonight I'm going to see my charmillo. Gonna pick guitar, fill fruit jar, and be gayo, son of a gun. We'll have big fun on the bayo. Fontenot, the dozy do, the place is buzzing. Folks come, kinfolks come around from, come from miles around by the dozen. Dressed in style, go hog wild. Mio Mayo, son of a gun, we'll have big fun on the bayou. Gonna save my mon. Gonna buy my hunting place on the bayou. Gonna save my mon. See, gonna Gonna settle down. Far from town. Gonna buy me a Pirro. Gonna catch all the fish on the bayou. Gonna save my mun, buy my hun what she needo. Son of a gun, we'll have great fun on the bayou. Whale jambalaya, crawfish pie, and a filet gumbo. For tonight, I'm gonna see my cher mio. Gonna pick guitar, fill a fruit jar, and be gay. Oh, son of a gun, have great fun on the bayou. Another Hank Williams song. Now that's honky tonkin' too. You know, just have fun in this world. But then Jones comes along and tells you how terrible it is. Put the bottle on the table. Let it stay there till I'm not able to see your, hear your voice, see your face in any place that I go. I've been trying for so long, but I just don't, just haven't seemed to have won. One drink, just one drink, and then another. One drink, just one drink, and then another. Right? We're trying to forget what we really are. And we say, man, I just can't forget. Let's have one drink. Maybe I'll forget, but nah, it wasn't enough. Have one drink, just one drink, and then another. I've been sitting here so long, but your memory, it just ain't gone. So one more drink of wine, and if you're still on my mind, one drink, just one drink, and then another. Trying to forget, can't forget reality, can we? We can't forget reality. These are spiritual songs. Just again, using, you know, the various motifs, popular motifs to drive home a point. Nothing better than just hanging out. Nothing better than just hanging out in a great mood here. Trying to pick up a few old memories. A grinning and a picking. And everything else. And here I sit on the back row of a church down the street, not too far from a place where we used to meet. It's finally getting through to me you found somebody new. But I'll go back to the place we used to, we both knew. It's not a fancy place, just a lonely bar in the far side of town where lonely people try to find someone and hope to settle down. But fate dealt me a blow that I just can't understand. Here I sit on the back row as you wed another man. Yeah, we're like sitting here and say, hey, the world, you know, it's not a, you know, continuity fear. Is the world going to finally do me right? You know, come back. You might, you know, won't come back. I never thought that after all these years I would still be sitting here with just a bottle and two glasses, sitting here in your favorite chair. And who knows, someday he may leave you and he may treat you wrong. He may treat you wrong. And here I'll sit. Here I'll be with the bottle, see, waiting for you all along. It's not a lonely place, just a tavern in the far side of town where lonely people come and to try to find someone and hope to settle down. But fate dealt me a blow that I'll never understand. Here I sit in the back row as you wed another man. So it's like spirit is, you know, trying to wed the ego, right? And spirit sitting on the back row, but is watching, itself, its true love, you know, pretending to be in love with what it's not. Pretending to be in love with what it's not. And Spirit says, wow, I'm still sitting here after all these years. After all these years, I'm still sitting here. And who knows, you might outlive him. Who knows, you might outlive him, and he might do you wrong. And here I'll sit in a tavern waiting for you. I've been waiting for you all along. I mean, we're hoping that we'll finally realize that, hey, you know, this option of trying to pretend, make pretense real, and stay pretending that we're not spirit, we're hoping that finally we'll wake up from this and say, hey, this is not what I really am. This is not where I really want to be with. That song is called On the Back Row by George Jones. Again, powerful spiritual song if we understand the symbology of it. Not a fancy place, just a simple bar on the far side of town. Just a little bar on the far side, yeah. We're just sitting here, aren't we? Just like on the back row, we're just sitting here on the back row hoping that, you know, our spirit doesn't keep exchanging vows with this stupid option of trying to make pretense real. We say, hey, ain't no good for you. You know, that ain't no good for you. Yeah, I just hope maybe I'll live them, or maybe they'll do you wrong, and here I'll sit, and there I'll be in the tavern waiting for you all along. So we're still here, you know, we're still here, you know, waiting for spirit to wake up. It's like that. We're waiting for us to stop pretending. We're waiting for ourselves to stop pretending. That's it. That's it. And we are still cruising along. We reached the 3:31 minute. We're in happy hour right now. Happy hour. I should get my book of songs. Hundreds of songs. Refresh my memory. We had a lady go up at church yesterday, and she can't sing, so she just said the words of the song, which was cool, because we know she can't sing, and God bless her, she tries, but she's smart enough to not even try this time. She just said, I'm just going to say it verbally, just say the words. That was great. Never happened before. Yeah, everybody understood. It's cool. That's fine. Don't need to sing. We get it. We get the words. We get the meaning. Don't have to be some great band singer belting it out, redlining the doggone board, you know.
In fact, I heard the band leader say, hey, you redlined
it. The band say, hey, you redlined it. I mean, you're singing too loud. Singing too loud. Come on, it's church, man. It's not a concert hall. Have a little respect. People are trying to reflect here and try to figure out, you know, what the heck is going on with the church right now. Everybody's scratching their head. This ain't your, you know, daddy's church. Anymore. It's not your mother's church anymore. So, uh-oh. Maybe we're, you know, slip sliding away. Yeah, Eddie Rabbit, drive my life away. Ooh, I'm driving my life away. Looking for a better way for me. Yeah, I'm driving my life away, right? Great song. Fantastic song. Drive my life away, Eddie Rabbit. Another spiritual song, heavy spiritual song. Man, I'm just driving my life away, looking for a better way, you know, for me. But meanwhile, I'm just squandering it. That's no way to live. You got to get after it like we have here for 3.5 hours. And when you get a little tired of getting after it, you stay on theme somehow. You bring a little light, levity, a little light, but it stays on theme here, right? bright lights, and there was a part of the bright lights. Yeah, ooh, I'm driving my life away, looking for a better way for me. Loved Eddie Rabbit. Yeah. Gene Nelson was that 14 karat mind, you know. Yeah. Lying by a railroad track in Denver with a broken heart and a half or something like that, and half a jug of wine. All because I tried to satisfy a 14 karat mind. Right? It's the ego, 14 karat mind. How do you satisfy a 14 karat mind? And see, the people understood that back then. They understood that this is really a spiritual meaning. Nowadays, it's lost. You know, unfortunately, the knuckleheads, these days, they don't understand that. They think, oh, this is just about romance, a guy and a girl. Blah, blah. No, it's really a spiritual meaning, 14-karat mind. That's the ego. That's the continuity fear. Likes bright, glittery things. I still remember the first day I saw you standing for Wilson's Tenant, Five and Dime. Staring into a jewelry case there. All the things that you could not afford or something like that. So I spent seven sawbuck dollars to, you know, satisfy your mind. Buy a brace, gold bracelet, satisfy your mind. But then, you know, things went bad. Things went bad. $700 bracelet, that's pretty expensive. Another great song, 14 Karat Mind. See, it's not about the musicianship. The musicianship is great, but it's about the spiritual meaning of the song. You know, they're putting one over on the pop public, thinking, oh yeah, I just want, you know, Herman's Hermits, you know, Mrs. Brown, you got a lovely daughter, or something, you know, all this fizzy pop stuff. No, they're singing about spiritual stuff, about, you know, of how we've fallen for the ego and how it devastates us, ruins our lives, and we don't really want it. I wonder how, you know, you are with Eddie Wilson. I wonder if he's still alive. He went and left his wife and children for a 14 karat mind. How the ego tempts us, you know, into its ways, and pulls us away from discipline, pulls us into, you know, bad lifestyle, distraction. It's all about that, you know. They're talking religious theme stuff being played on the radio because they dressed it up, you know, in a little more pop modern themes. Stuff today is coming straight out of Sodom and Gomorrah. You know the music. It's absolutely terrible. It's like the racket. You know, it's a racket straight out of Sodom and Gomorrah. All the din, you know, it's like they taping the din, you know, of the cities, you know, the wicked cities. And they're been playing the din, you know, on the radio or on whatever, YouTube, wherever. It's like what? Yeah, what the heck is this? A bunch of devils beating kettles. You know, more cowbell, more cowbell. Come on, make more racket. I haven't been listening to those songs in a long time. Maybe I'll do listen to them again a little bit. I mean, if we go this late, if we're going to go all night, you know, I better pull out some olds, pull out some songs. Wow, this is an incredible video. 3:40. This is awesome. I think we might be hitting a record here, folks. I feel great. Very lighthearted.